my dang goodness. Yeah. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Oh my gosh.
I can't believe
we're playing this dang old game again. I'm so excited.
Polo's excited.
I can.
Polo's always...
Polo, are you excited?
That was my whole sentence. He was just always.
Always.
He's Polo's forever.
He's a forever dog.
He'll never...
Not
Polo. I'm so proud of him. Hi guys, how's it going?
It's good, I've got a sandwich.
Sweet kind of sandwich did you get?
This is the Club Supreme. It's got turkey, roast beef, and bacon.
You know what else is supreme? You.
Thanks, Fox.
This is Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective Jack the Ripper and West End Adventures. A standalone sequel expansion to Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective. This is a cooperative mystery solving game where we will go back to late 1800s London and solve us some dang mysteries.
I see that Sherlock has a new Abby there.
Yeah, he's cleaned up his look. He's got some new filters. Yeah, we've got a new map of London. There's another map on the other side of it that maybe we'll visit. We have
so many maps.
Four adventures that will make up a mini campaign that we'll start on this evening, and then some more adventures that will make up the rest of our time with the mystery solving adventure. It's kind of like a choose your own adventure kind of story, in that we're going to read sort of a synopsis, sort of a parlor room scene where someone comes to Holmes, presumably with an issue of some kind, and then he will send us, the Baker Street Irregulars, to try and investigate this mystery. And at the end, we'll try and solve it and then compare our results with those of the master detective, Sherlock Holmes himself. Sometimes we do pretty darn well. Sometimes we score so far in the negatives in terms of those points, in terms of those great little Sherlock points that you so want. Goodness gracious. Does anyone have any questions or any recollections that they need before we get started?
Do we have any other pencils?
Where
are we asked? That was also my question.
Here are some pencils for you. Careful you don't hurt yourself.
Is there one more by chance?
Absolutely. I have literally hundreds of pencils in this house.
Yeah.
Here.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Here.
Green.
Enjoy a pencil, why don't you?
No eraser.
Do you need a sharpener? That is a inking pen. I mean, you can use it if you want, but I wouldn't recommend it.
I was just curious about it.
I mean,
are there any differences?
I love a good pen.
In this version of the game.
Rules-wise.
Besides, yeah, like.
No, rules wise, it is exactly the same so far as I can tell.
Cool.
The only real difference is with this miniature campaign, where we are investigating the Jack the Murder murders. Jack the Ripper. Jack the Murder Rippers. Is Jack the Murder. Wow. Someone throw me in the garbage can like Oscar the Grouch, because that is where I belong. That comes with a little bit of a warning. This mystery and the ones following it are based on some pretty grisly murders from an actual real-life monster. That may be a little bit of a sensitive subject for some people, so if you need to bow out for this one, please. Yeah, it's a mature content warning above and beyond the usual kind of bloody messes that we encounter on our stream anyway. The other thing to warn you about is that we're going to play the mystery. We're going to basically spoil this chapter of the game. If you've never played one of these before, you might want to tune in to this one in particular. But then we heartily recommend, if you're interested in playing more of them yourself with your friends, you can play it all by yourself with just a loved one, with a group at a party or something like that. It's terrific. But we are going to spoil the story for you, because this is the mystery. It's figuring out what the story is, then trying to figure it out. So proceed with caution. And then the entire chat just emptied out. So, without further ado, we'll begin the first case in this miniature Jack the Murder Ripper. The case of Marianne Nichols, which takes place on September 1st, 1888, which is also the date of our newspaper. Every story comes with the newspaper of the day. the Edison phonograph story on the other side as a good chuckle of a opener. You know what the other side of a piece of paper is? Yeah, there you go. At the top. This is the Whitechapel campaign, Chapter 1. Early in the morning, we're rounded up by Wiggins, the leader of the Baker Street Irregulars, someone who we're well familiar with. And faced with our sleep-filled faces and our reproving glares, he explains to us that he received an urgent message from Dr. Watson requesting our help. Less than 2 weeks after the resolution of the Lionized Lions case, which you'll remember from our first series.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I remember that.
Yeah, what happened to all those lions? They're just loose in Great Britain somewhere. We recovered two of them. There's still six. Actually, there's another story in there where there's just 13 crocodiles just loose in Belgium somewhere. There's all kinds of stuff going on, it seems.
The world is a zoo.
It is. It really is a zoo. There's just animals everywhere you look. After the resolution of the aforementioned case, we're now headed back in the direction of 221B Baker Street, our carriage driving at a fast pace in the morning fog. Wiggins rings the bell, Mrs. Hudson opens the door, and apparently unsurprised at our visit, she invites us up to the first floor. Watson is waiting for us in the living room, pacing. "Ah, gentlemen, I'm happy to see you," Watson exclaims. "Come in and sit down, I'll explain why I asked you over." Watson settles into a sofa and we copy him. We're surprised by the absence of Sherlock Holmes, but the care Watson puts into not speaking too loudly tells us that his flatmate must be sleeping in his room. On the corner of the fireplace, balanced on the coal bucket, is a case containing a hypodermic syringe and a bottle of morphine. "Your message worried us a bit, Doctor," begins Wiggins. "I understand. Please, excuse me. How can I explain it to you? I've been watching the same spectacle for a week without daring say a word to him. His brilliant mind does not stand, as he says himself, stagnation. The absence of work, puzzles, investigations, or mysteries to solve plunges him into the most depressing state of lethargy, without counting his rituals, which worry me to no end." "You're talking about these injections," interrupts Wiggins. "It turns out this entire mystery is just like, there's no mysteries here whatsoever. We're just here to stage an intervention. That's the whole of it. The whole Jack the Murder scene is like completely gone." Oh, mercy.
Got him out of his room.
"Yes, I'm a witness to these sessions, these episodes with morphine, 3 times a day. He alternates morphine and cocaine to the detriment of his health." I believe cocaine was super legal back then, if I remember correctly. "One would believe he's incapable of facing daily life and its banality." "I'm afraid I don't know how I could help, Mr. Holmes," answers Wiggins. "Who better than you to do so? You're his friend and a doctor on top of that." "Mm-hmm. I know, Wiggins. You're entirely right. If you knew the feeling of guilt which each night overwhelms me..." This is really quite the intro. Yeah. This is not what I expected to be reading here. "Which each night overwhelms me. My conscience is reproaching me for my lack of courage to protest when I see him destroy his health this way." Watson pauses before continuing. "Let's get to the point of my message, Wiggins. Head Inspector Aberline came here himself to request the help of the greatest detective on the Whitechapel murder case. As Holmes isn't in a state to receive him, I fashioned a vague excuse and assured him that I'd send our best people to help him as soon as possible. Our reputation is at stake. You can count on us, Dr. Watson. We'll find Aberline and start right away. Give Mr. Holmes our salutations when he wakes up. Thank you, Wiggins. I'm sure Holmes will be happy with our initiative if he ever comes back to reality. Maybe he'll even be able to help us in our noble undertaking." And then that's the end of the synopsis, but the next page has what I believe to be the actual illustration of the police news on the day of poor Polly's discovery.
"Sad death at Bedlington. Attempted murder and suicide in Wales. Revolting and mysterious murder of a woman. Bucks Row, Whitechapel. That's the one."
Indeed.
We have some relevant newspaper articles, at least two.
Okay.
Go ahead and read them.
Oh, please.
Alright. First one is...
Remember to project. You're as far away from the microphone as can be.
Alright. First up, horror in Whitechapel. A woman was found yesterday in Bucks Row completely eviscerated. The Investigators from Scotland Yard have managed to establish, not without difficulty, that it was Marianne Nichols, nicknamed Polly, who lived in a shelter at 18 Thrall Street of that same neighborhood. At 9 o'clock this morning, the deceased body was moved to a separate room in the old Montague Street morgue that had been turned into an improvised operating room, and Dr. Ralph Llewellyn performed a post-mortem examination. This afternoon, at the Working Lads Institute, Whitechapel Road, Mr. Wynne E. Baxter will open an investigation into the death of the unfortunate woman in presence of the police authorities, represented by Inspectors Lestard and Aberlin of Scotland Yard. In order for the police not to be slowed down in its investigative work, and so that they have the advantage of having in their possession all of the information gathered under oath, it was decided to skip over the preliminary formalities of the investigation at this time. Any information regarding the case must be brought to the Commercial Street Police Station and Spatial Fields.
And the Spatial Fields?
Ittle Fields? Fields? F-B-I-T-A-L Fields.
Spittle?
Spinal.
Spittle Fields?
Spital.
Spinal.
Fulgore.
Anyway, the second article that might be relevant is titled, A Witness Found.
Ah, excellent.
Robert Paul...
I did it!
Robert Paul Carter has stated this to our reporter. Got onto Bucks Row at exactly 3:45. It was dark, and I was hurrying to be on time for work. A man then came towards me. Because the neighborhood isn't safe, I took a defensive stance. But actually, he just came close and told me, come see this woman. Then I saw the woman lying on her back. I took her wrist and her hands were cold. She seemed dead. It was too dark to see if there was any blood. I thought that an outrage might have happened to her. I was really late, so I left with the other man to look for a body. I saw one on Baker's Row, who was getting vagrants to move along. I told him what I had seen, but he didn't say if he'd go look or not. In any case, he continued to deal with the vagrants, and I thought it was shameful, because I did tell him that the woman was dead.
Well, case closed.
That's it.
Yep.
Those were the two immediately relevant ones. There's certainly a lot more in this newspaper.
Yes.
Those two jumped out at me.
Well.
We can go to murder scene. We can go to her place, right?
I think you're quite right. We'll use the Sirirac designate who the lead investigator is. Lois can start us off. We'll decide, obviously, as a group, but the final decision as to where we visit.
There was someone specifically along to talk to us, wasn't there?
Aberlin, the inspector at Scotland Yard, I believe.
That may not be a bad...
Definitely in favor of the murder scene.
Yes. Remember that, I think, on the other side of that manual...
All the people.
Has the list of all the people that we can visit.
Policeman from the newspaper articles poking me in the brain a little bit, though. The one who was shooing off vagrants and wasn't interested in a dead body.
Yeah.
Well, maybe. I could also imagine that if some stranger just wandered up and said, hey, there's some woman back there, 3:45 in the morning, you might imagine that, well, I need to deal with this right now.
But he did say dead. He specifically says in the interview that he mentioned to the police officer that she was dead. I mean,
right, but if she's dead, and there's live vagrants before you, I'm going to take care of the live vagrants.
I don't know. Vagrants seem like a pretty minor thing compared to a dead body.
Maybe he got into the business specifically to take care of vagrants. Maybe that's his favorite thing to do at 3:45 in the morning.
Maybe, but I'm retaining a suspicious tag on that, but nothing we can do about it for now.
No, we don't even know what his name is.
We don't know anything about him other than
that. Well, we know that he loves taking care of vagrants.
Any objections to going to the murder scene real quick?
I like the idea.
Yeah, I think that works fine.
Seems like a good first.
Did someone write down where it was?
It
said in the newspaper.
It's in the newspaper.
It's in the newspaper.
Bucks Row, Whitechapel.
Other side, I think.
Yeah, it was this area, yeah.
Horror in Whitechapel.
Yes. So she lived at 18 Thrall Street, not Carl Street. The examination happened on Old Montague Street, and she was found in Bucks Row.
Is Bucks Row where you want to go?
So
is Bucks Row a street? Or?
It is. So, Fieldy, why don't you flip the map for us?
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh. This is the Whitechapel neighborhood.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh. So we might be able to just find Bucks Row on the map.
Here it is.
And then visit it. There we go.
Hmm.
Whitechapel Station construction site.
Yep.
Right, so this is East Central. Okay, I see. So
yeah.
Is there a street number by any chance? Let's see.
We have a 2 and a 102 to work with here.
Well, we might be able to get more info by going to Scotland Yard also.
And right. They may be able to narrow down which one of these is.
Well, they said that the investigation is being handled somewhere else, though.
Small legends here that might be relevant to see. I can't see what they say myself, but for once I faced the map to face Fieldy, so.
I think what that is saying, like, and if you continue down this way, there's...
It connects to other places on the main map.
Yeah, it said that...
These are, like, docks and things.
Dr. The Well.
It said the investigation is being based out of Commercial Street Police Station.
There's Commercial Road.
Or Commercial Street, or is it the same one?
Oh.
Might be the same one.
Well, we could check the directory for police stations, right?
Yep. Yeah, it should definitely be these stations.
Somewhere.
Commercial Street Police Station.
Spectacular. So I'll just close this.
Forever.
It's even highlighted.
Cool.
Should we go there?
Yeah, it seems like
we don't have a specific murder scene, yeah.
Okay. That's
a logical place to start.
Indeed.
EC100.
Will I be the list keeper?
Yes, please. You're so good at it.
Thanks.
They're good. The answers are in the back or upside down. So
nice.
Easy enough to go. Wrong page.
Yeah.
All right, let's see. We are going to 100 East.
So what we do is we find a location on the map that we want to visit, and then we coordinate both that number and that neighborhood, in this case EC for East Central, which lines up with a paragraph in the book, sometimes many paragraphs.
Yes.
Yes.
We've got several paragraphs here.
I love it. Give me those sweet, sweet murder paragraphs.
All right. At the Commercial Street Police Station, we enter the office we were pointed to and discover a rotund man of average height, relatively young but already balding, and wearing sideburns. He's busy looking at a defective fob watch through a large magnifying glass. The item is disassembled on the desk, and the inspector is reassembling the minute parts of its precision mechanism using a pair of fine tweezers. Inspector Aberline? Yes, come in. Allow me to finish, and I'm all yours, gentlemen. Answers Aberline without looking up. Wiggins, and these are my colleagues. We come on behalf of Mr. Holmes for the investigation of the Whitechapel murder. A smile cracks on the inspector's face, who stops his work on the spot. You see, fixing things relaxes me. I'm yours. Aberline pulls out a black notebook from his desk. According to my preliminary investigation, Marianne Nichols, called Polly, was 43 years old. She was a poor, unfortunate, long ago estranged from her husband, tended to drink, and as with many others in Whitechapel, forced to prostitute herself in order to get enough to pay for a night in a shelter or a room in the best of cases. She had been living at the White House on Flower and Dean Street, a night shelter, for a week. She was seen around 11 at night, the night before yesterday, on Whitechapel Road. Then around 12:30 at the Frying Pan, a neighborhood watering hole. Then she was seen at the Thrall Street night shelter by the owner, who refused to give her a bed as she had no money and was drunk. Then, around 3:45 yesterday morning, two passersby who were headed to their work discovered her body in Bucks Row. Her dress had been hiked up to her stomach. Then, Officer Neal, who was making his round, arrived barely a few minutes later. Could you give us the identities of the passersby who discovered the body? The one who discovered the body is Charles Cross, a carter at Pickford's. Do you have a lead, Inspector? I've delegated to Lestrade the research into recent deaths under similar circumstances, as well as assaults and cases closed after the fact. He is quite confident about one specific case, Smith, and we may need to investigate on it. Nichols' murderer may have left clues which would allow us to link these ancient cases. Come back and give me your report tonight. There's a little bold statement underneath that says, Holmes isn't taking part in this investigation. Hmm. You can follow up to 15 leads, including this one and the ones previously followed, then move on to questions.
Oh, there's a time limit.
Interesting. So okay.
15, not counting the, or including this one?
Including this one and the ones previously followed. So.
Oh.
Wow, we screwed up. We should have just run around town.
Hit everything and then this last.
Oh, well, 14 left.
Huh.
Does anybody need any info repeated or want to see it?
I imagine we're going to be returning to that quite a bit. Why don't I give you a
markers?
Yeah.
We're going to have to choose wisely.
Uh-huh. Not like we usually do. Yeah. My craft, my craft.
Well,
by 15, we should probably have an okay idea.
Well, we didn't find out exactly where the crime scene was, but we did at least find out which officer was first on the scene.
We did.
Definitely want to talk, I think.
Did it give us where he's stationed, is that right?
Did they give us where he was stationed?
They gave us some kind of information.
They said... Carter, oh wait.
That was
you're talking about the cop?
Yeah.
Officer Neal, who was making his round, arrived barely a few minutes later.
Okay.
That's all.
Let's see if we can find a Neal in the directory.
Yes.
More than one.
Neal, N-E-A-L?
Mm-hmm. Also interesting.
N-E-I-L.
N-E-I-L.
Also interesting that we can start to piece together the timeline.
Mm-hmm.
There's only the one, okay. So I assume he's our man.
Yeah, well, there's only one.
Interesting.
In our effort to narrow down the crime scene, he would be the next person to poke at. And if not him, then that Charles Crossbow.
And we don't know the name of the other person?
No, I don't think they have a name for
the second. Wasn't that guy the guy that they interviewed for the story in the paper?
Well, it wasn't Charles Cross in the paper, I don't remember.
No, wasn't it, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Probably, yeah.
Oh, Robert Paul Carter.
Okay, so we actually do know both. Okay.
All right.
So who was that?
Cross would be the one.
That was the guy that was the second witness to the crime that talked to Officer Neal.
Okay.
Wait, hold on. Just a second. I'm remembering something important.
The crocodiles.
Yeah, Charles Cross would be the one who walked up to Robert Paul and said, come look at this.
Right, I said Robert Paul is the second witness to the crime.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was double checking, sorry.
Yep. I mean, you could just ask me. I'm right here. So what should we do? The police officer, I guess?
Maybe the last place he was seen, which was that shelter she was turned away from, right?
Maybe. We could also try and track down the guy that did the autopsy, which I think we had some information on from this.
Like a Dr. Llewellyn or something like that.
Dr. Ralph Llewellyn at the separate room on Old Montague Street. At the morgue where it had been turned into an improvised operating room. Okay.
Hmm.
So we could go to the morgue and see if they have any information for us there.
That is also a solid one.
We got lots of solid possibilities.
I think we should talk. I think we should go to the morgue. That's what I think.
Okay.
Oh, bless you. Morgs. Is it on here, perhaps? Montague. Well, first of all, is it in dark? No. Is it in not dark? There! Ha-ha!
Morgue.
Yes. So that's
E24. EC, I think, right?
I think it turns into E on this side of the barrier, my friend.
Oh, I didn't see that.
E24. Look at all these sweet, sweet river paragraphs. Mm. We enter the Old Montague Street morgue by a large wooden double door, which is cracked open, stepping over a large, dubious, and malodorous puddle. Not a puzzle. We don't have to figure out like matchsticks in order to get inside the building. The entrance is vast, cold, sparsely furnished, and burdened by nauseating scents. Mixture of the odors of corpses and chemicals. Only three tables occupy the hall's central space, and a few buckets, bowls, and other copper containers are scattered here or and there, next to piles of clothes and rags left on the ground. On one of the tables is a wooden case. We approach in silence, conscious as to what the box must contain. Within is the body of a woman in her 40s, partially covered by a gray drape, stained with brown spots. Her head, with hair slicked down by blood, is tilted back, her eyes closed for eternity. A gaping gash holds her throat open. We gaze upon the livid corpse in Whitechapel's glacial morgue without any of us daring to lift the drape when Wiggins turns around, alerted by the sounds of footsteps in the yard. A short time later, a small man comes in dressed with worn out and patched clothes with a beard that goes to his eyes. What? He stops, surprised to find us here. Evidently unsure as to the attitude he should adopt, he glares at us while frowning with bushy eyebrows. Taking advantage of this brief moment of hesitation, Wiggins speaks to the guard using a likable tone. Greetings, sir. Allow me to introduce myself. I'm Detective Wiggins, and here are my assistants. We're leading an investigation in collaboration with Metropolitan Police. We'd like to ask you a few questions. Do you work here?
Yeah, I'm Robert Mann, one of the managers of the morgue, answers the man in a hesitant tone.
Were you the one present when the body of Marianne Nichols was brought in? Wiggins then gestures at the box behind him.
Yeah, I got to the yard at 5. I live here, but there wasn't anyone left. No doctor, no police inspector. Just the ambulance and the odd and the stiff left on the table in a cold bodies room. What happened next?
I closed the door, locked it, and went to have breakfast. Then James and I, James Hatfield, he's a colleague from the morgue who must have arrived around 6. We went back to the cold bodies room and we undressed the stiff, sorry, the body. We washed it and perfumed it with a mix of water and phenolic acid. All that before the doctor came in to make him save time and keep him from nasty stenches.
Where are clothes? Robert Mann points at a pile of clothes heaped on the floor. Can we take a look?
I don't see why you wouldn't be able to.
Come closer. Discover a thick chestnut overcoat with large copper buttons in which a man and horse are carved. Wait.
A man and horse?
Are carved, yeah. Oh, on the buttons.
Oh. Yeah.
I thought, like, on the coat. Like, impressive.
What does it mean?
It's a clue.
I chiseled it.
A dress of brown linen, two gray wool skirts onto which have been stenciled the name of Lambeth Hospice, which are covered in dried blood, two whalebone corsets, flannel underwear hardened by abundant layers of dried blood, black woolen socks with large ribs, men's boots cut at the top and the tip and on the heel, and a black straw bonnet bordered with black velvet. We notice that the clothes are cut in many places.
The clothes are all cut and torn, asks Wiggins, perplexed. Yeah, we're the ones who did that to undress her. It's faster. She was wearing one hell of a layer of tattered rags, and most of it was hardened by dried blood. Everywhere on her back, from head to toe, it's a real pain to remove, and she was resisting too, the old biddy. We could almost believe she didn't want to be stripped. She was already stiff as a statue.
Her pockets were empty, asked Wiggins while searching the overcoat.
There was a white handkerchief, a comb, and a broken mirror. What a mess! Not used to this sort of business. In general, I take in pensioners who have turned in their keys, and drowned bodies found the Thames before they leave for the pine field.
Well, there was a hospice mentioned, I guess.
There was the hospice.
That's some new information.
And then there was also James Hatfield, his colleague.
Yeah, the other morgue guy.
But that's just another morgue guy. They didn't say the name. Oh, well, you know the name of the doctor. Yeah. It's that Llewellyn guy. I was kind of hoping he would be there, but...
Must be at his own office or something.
Maybe so, yeah.
There's a horse button.
Maybe we're looking for something connected to a horse.
We're looking for... The murder was a horse.
Maybe.
Did we want to...
Or a centaur.
Are we trying to find, like, information on the autopsy or whatever?
Yeah, there is a Dr. Ralph Llewellyn in the books.
Okay.
Yeah, I wanted to
It's not Meeks, right? It says he performs the autopsies on all bodies found during cases, but
It said specifically. Okay. Yeah.
I think it's over a couple of our usual ones for this.
Why was she taken to this shabby place?
I think just because it was close.
It's weird that, it seems like there's so much time that passed before they got to around to inspecting it.
They said she was already stiff. Yeah.
Why was she so dead by then?
Good question. Of course, if it's a bad neighborhood, people wouldn't move around a lot at night. She may not have just been found for a while. But that could mean she died much closer to 12 when she was at the previous location than we may have thought.
That's true. So hitting up her last known location might be more relevant.
Yeah, but when it was 4 hours distance,
Right.
But not so much distant. And there's still Officer Neil and Charles Cross. Or high on my interest list, at least.
Yeah, I'm suddenly a lot more interested in finding out what went on the last time someone saw her alive.
Yeah, Thrall Street. Shelter.
That was
it. It's you!
That was close to midnight, if I remember that first reading correctly.
Maybe we want to look back at the first clue to get the time.
She had been living at the White House on Flower and Dean. She was seen around 11 at night the night before yesterday on Whitechapel Road, then around 12:30 at the Frying Pan.
Okay.
Then she was seen at the Thrall Street Night Shelter by the owner.
Thrall Street Night Shelter.
It's some unknown time after midnight.
Yes.
Wikipedia says in humans, rigor mortis can occur as soon as 4 hours post-mortem.
Interesting. So, interesting.
I didn't inspect her until 6 o'clock, I think, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Welcome.
So she could have died at 2 o'clock.
Oh, past 6 o'clock, because the other guy arrived and then they went to go get breakfast.
Mm.
True, true.
Yeah, but they put her in a cold room, right?
She was just on a slab.
They did call it the cold bodies room.
But they cut her clothes off first, I think. Or soon after putting her in there, because that was the first thing they did.
Yeah, I don't think they refrigerated her.
No.
I guess not.
Yeah. Yeah, I think going to either the Frying Pan or perhaps more relevantly the Thrall Street shelter might be a good idea.
Yeah, that probably. Shelter seems like a plastic location.
Maybe all of our other leads have been...
There's the Frying Pan. What is it? Thrall Street something?
Thrall Street.
Well, she was discovered over here, so it's probably in between the two, right?
Yeah, let's actually... we can start to... Oh, should we get little guys put on the map?
Oh, yeah, we should absolutely do that.
Here's Thrall Street.
She started... last known location.
Didn't the paper mention a specific number on Thrall Street?
18.
There's an 18.
That's where she lived, yes.
That's where she lived, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I got you.
Or at least that's where she's listed as living.
Right, because the shelter. Yeah,
right.
And the point of death is somewhere over there.
Perfect. 18 Thrall Street. So 18E.
Oh.
18E.
Yep.
Oh, I thought Thrall Street was over here.
No, it is, but you're looking for the E district.
Okay. Yeah.
That's Boba Fett.
Okay.
He's here to help.
All right.
Why does he look like an
I think he killed him.
Here we go. 18E.
I don't think Boba Fett killed anyone.
That's true.
Yeah.
Except himself. Actually, he survived.
Boba Fett? Where?
Spoilers.
All right. Between Commercial Street and Brick Lane, we enter the narrow streets in search of the Thrall Street Lodging House. In placed, blood coming from nearby slaughterhouses flows freely over the ground.
Oh.
Maybe just in places?
Yeah.
Charming neighborhood.
Yeah. And some of those classic consulting detective typos.
And Aaron Pullo is taking advantage of that and is licking the pavement.
No!
No!
He loves blood in this AU.
Stepping into a short alleyway, we are forced to pull out our handkerchiefs to protect ourselves from the pestilential smell of the stench, which, coming from a nearby slaughterhouse, wafts over to us.
Pestilential Stench is the name of my death metal band. Or it was in high school.
The neighborhood in itself is formed by a mass of houses of 3 or 4 stories, which seem to have been built with no plans, each inhabited from the basement to the attic, forming gaps so narrow that one could cross the alley by going from one window to the next. Luke, the locksmith of our small band, who spent his childhood here, explains to us that in this thieves' den of a neighborhood, doors are useless as there's nothing to steal. It's in the middle of this, the Daedalus?
Yeah, like a labyrinth.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Okay.
I'm Egyptian!
We find the Thrall Street Doss House. We enter into a vast kitchen, smoky from the chimney detached from the brick wall. The beams and ceiling have been darkened by soot. A bare-bones iron gas pipe feeds a lone lamp in the middle of the table. It's the only source of light, other than the fireplace, around which wet clothes are set. Pensioners, surrounded by children of all ages, kneeling by the fire, are grilling herrings, which put out a strong smell, while others are drying cigar stumps. On the whitewashed walls are written in large characters a few precepts which preach resignation. This message reads, "The earth is a vale of tears.
Oh my God.
Blessed be those who leave it. Do not look above yourself, but beneath you. And miserable though you may be, you will find more miserable still."
Okay.
Thanks for coming to my house to play this game.
All right. Well.
I'm going to need some of that cocaine.
I need a polo.
Well, you'll find him by the blood.
Oh, God. He's eating it.
The manager, an imposing man in his 60s, is settled on a stool not far from the chimney. He's badly shaven, bloated by alcohol, and wears an old hunting jacket which is worn and torn to the skin. "Today, I have a lead cap with a cast iron visor," he complains while gazing at his cooking meal. And clearly regret
a terrible place we found ourselves. Let's get out of here.
Even Athos would be better than this.
He clearly regretting the amount he imbibed the night before. "Polly lived here for a while with her friend, Nellie the Telegraph. We call her that, as she's the first one to spread rumors. Polly stayed here for 3 weeks. Polly was an unfortunate, but she kept her smile and her good mood. But to pay for her bed, though, that was another matter. How many times did I have to credit her a meal or a bed? That Polly, she could never hold down a job, so she'd end up prostituting. But lately, she didn't pay anymore. So when she came back from the frying pan, half drunk and without a penny on the night of the 13th, I refused to give her a bed. She left it around 1:40, promising to come back and pay and asking me to keep her bed for her. She was all happy and wouldn't stop boasting about having a funny new bonnet. That's the last thing she told me. Do you know who's the bastard that ended her?" "No, we're leading our own investigation. This Nellie, you know where we could find her?" "The poor woman is snoring in her flea box as we speak. She's alone and has much trouble paying her dues. If you could give her a hand, if you could give her a hand, you'd be kind." Let's go up and see her. "Give me what the Telegraph owes me directly, and I'll keep her from spending it down her gullet at the pub."
Wow.
Okay. We give a few extra pence to the manager, asking ourselves if he would actually deduct it from Nellie's tab. And he ends up standing up, arming himself with a lantern, and he guides us to the first floor. We discover a filthy dorm room in which are stacked in bunks similar to coffins, poor women. The manager Wakes up a woman in her 50s with a worn face and sunken eyes, without care, much like the rest of the room. With a tie? Yeah.
You're gonna have to give her a really funny voice.
Oh, man. gotta break the misery somehow. With a tired tread, Nellie joins us at the stairway. The manager goes back down and leaves us in the darkness.
Here, if I may, let me interject really quick.
Yes.
Here's a news report from Germany. The population of Hamburg was consternated to learn that due to a mistake of inattention, 13 crocodiles had escaped from the bridge of a steamship returning from Africa, from where they were taken in order to be sold to various zoos on the continent. These gigantic reptiles, relates the Standard News correspondent, are now in the Elbe River.
Good!
Yep.
Nice.
Well, back to the story.
Meanwhile,
in the darkness.
You should have warned me. I don't even know if I want to try and give her a voice. I feel like I'm going to offend somebody. You should have warned me of your coming.
See? Better already.
I feel better.
Remember to rhyme. Make sure these rhyme.
I would have cleaned up my face like I did yesterday for Inspector Aberline, answers Nellie the Telegraph, smiling despite her fatigued state. What can you tell us about Polly? Asked Wiggins. Oh, yes, of course. She wore a button that had a horse. No. yes, of course, answers Nellie in a half tone, obviously moved. Polly would often ask me to reserve a mat for her here. I liked her despite her character. She found herself alone, with no man, I mean, as much because of her moods as due to the drink. Yet she had five kids?
Oh, good.
But it had been years since she had seen even one of them. Oh. So, you know, alcohol. No one really had a reason to throw stones at her. And we felt a bit safer with the Nichols gang in the area. A bit more than with the Bobbies. Nellie suddenly stops, pensive. When did you see her for the last time? Asked Wiggins, bringing Nellie the Telegraph back to reality. It was right before. Oh my God! When I think about it, I met her by luck around 2:30 in the morning. Da da da. At the corner of Osborne Street and Whitechapel Road, across from the church. It was raining cats and pillows. I was coming back from the docks where I had been watching the fire at the Shadwell warehouses, and the rain wasn't enough to quench the blaze. The sky was red, and there was lightning.
Wow.
So we... Are you sure we're not in Yarna? Polly was drunk. She was staggering along a wall. I went to see her, and she explained to me that she had earned 3 times the amount needed to pay for her bed that night, but that she spent everything at the pub. Mm. She didn't want to go to a, quote, penny sit-ups, unquote. So I begged her to come back with me, but she still wanted to earn the 4 pennies to pay the sleep merchant. I'll be back soon, she told me. The church's clock began to toll, and I saw her stagger towards Whitechapel Road, and then she disappeared into the darkness. If only she had listened to me. Did you know her former husband? No, I never saw him, but Polly had told me about him. He was called William, and had stopped paying her pension long ago, when he learned that she was prostituting herself. The last time she saw her ex-husband was 2 years ago in June, at the burial of her brother, who died burned alive because of the explosion of a paraffin lamp.
I like that sentence ending at the explosion. You know the one.
I think that William lived with his sister, He had gotten the kids a few years ago when he learned that Polly lived with Thomas. Thomas? Thomas Drew, a blacksmith who has his shop between Raven Row and Whitechapel Road. She had gotten a crush on him at the time, and their thing lasted a few years, but it ended with badly. She didn't have any new friends, not as far as I know. As we're about to go down the stairs, Wiggins turns back and speaks one last time to Nellie. I almost forgot. We paid your tab to the manager.
Whew!
Okay!
Yeah.
I hope someone's taking notes on that. I was just over here having my soul put in a vice.
What a mess.
She had a crush on Thomas the blacksmith.
Yeah.
And that didn't work out.
Yep.
Okay.
And she was seen at 2:30.
2:30.
Around, yep, here.
Around that Zambi.
Yep.
And she was found at when? 4:30?
3:45.
3:45.
Around 3:45 over here.
Okay.
There's definitely a short distance on this map, time-wise. I mean, it's like maybe 15 minutes at the most walking distance.
Indeed. I wonder if... You know, we haven't investigated the crime scene yet, though we don't yet have a better idea of which number it might be.
Yeah, Charles.
I'm willing to bet the red one might be the correct one.
Yeah, Charles Cross or Officer Neo would be the ones who might narrow it down for us if we wanted to try narrowing it down.
Sure.
Yeah. And they're both people who
I'm not certain that they're going to give us any more information that Aberline hasn't already, though.
Yeah, the one thing I would like to confirm is that Officer Neal is the guy that they actually spoke to when they spoke to somebody. I'm still bothered by that officer's behavior about the dead body.
And the main thing I'm curious about with Cross is he the guy who asked the other guy to come see, you know?
That's what it sounded like.
What it sounded like.
That's true.
Either of them might be able to tell us the crime scene. Charles Cross has the extra thing of being able to verify that detail, so maybe he's the one to go with first.
Is the crime scene, is that where the first witness said that he saw her?
Somewhere around this area. I mean, dead. So.
And then did he say which way he went to find the police officer?
Well, yeah, he might have said that. Where's the newspaper? Let's see. I saw one on Baker's Row, so he went to Baker's Row to find a body.
Oh, that's down here.
Yeah. So only a few minutes away. So, Charles Cross.
I'm cool with that.
Sure.
Okay. Cool. Where's my goings?
Criminal court. Cross. It is last name first, right? Or is it first name then last?
No, it should be last than first.
Something Cross with a K or something, was it?
Could I go from Croquet Association to Crossingham's Lodging House to Crow and Roll?
What? He's made up.
Acquired at Pickford's.
Ah, yes. Pickford's.
Ah. Then perhaps that's where we need to investigate.
Yeah, Pickford's. If he's not in, if Charles Cross isn't there, let's talk to Pickford's.
It would probably be the businesses, though.
They list them in here, too.
Pickford's that's
yeah. Pickford's
okay,
is a 98EC.
98EC.
Oh, right. I guess he doesn't own his own residence.
All right, 98EC. We arrived at Pickford's warehouses looking for the man who discovered the body of Polly and were directed to a mustachioed man waiting on his cart near the eastern exit of the building.
It's me!
Mustachio!
Yeah, I was the one who found the body, not Robert, says Charles
What's Cross. Wrong with my voice?
says Charles Cross while frowning his thick, bushy eyebrows. But I've already told everything to Inspector Abernay. Yes, yes, but we're leading an independent investigation. Do you mind telling us your story?
Yes. Get ready.
Yeah. Well, all right. I was leaving to come work here. I'm a carter, and I have to cross all of Whitechapel. As I'm going along Bucks Row, I see a dark silhouette on the ground, near the door near the stables. I thought it was a tarpaulin at first, as it was still dark out and there was fog on top of that morning. I come closer and I realize it's a woman. There was her bonnet on the ground next to her. I first thought she was drunk, so I lean over to see what had happened to her. At that point, I hear footsteps. I turn around, it was Robert, another carter from around here. So I come over to come and see. I touch the woman's hand and see that it's cold. I didn't tell Robert that she must be dead. To check, he places his hand on her chest and tells me that she's still breathing.
Mm. What?
To check, I'm reading again because that's kind of important.
Yeah.
To check, he places his hand on her chest and tells me that she's still breathing. She was all askew, her skirt raised to her waist. We thought she'd been outraged. We covered her up enough to get the police. We found an officer, Meisen his name was, who was making his rounds at the corner of Hanbury and Old Montague. We told him what we had discovered on Bucks Row. Then we headed straight to work, Robert and I, by going along Hanbury Street. We split up a bit at Commercial Street since Robert works at Corbett's Court. What time was it when you found the body? A bit before four, I'd say. I was late. Was there a lot of blood? No, I hadn't noticed any. You met no one just before? No, not that I remember, but as I told you, it was pretty dark. In any case, I didn't see anyone else in the street.
Is it?
That's it, but that's a very different account.
Seriously?
Yeah.
The newspaper guy. I didn't just read the newspaper.
No, was, absolutely.
I mean, she was dead.
So the other guy, Robert Hall, says specifically, got onto Bucks Row at 3:45, it was dark. Man came towards me, but actually he just came close and said, come see this woman. Then I saw the woman lying on her back, I took her wrist, her hands were cold, she seemed dead, it was too dark to see if there was any blood. I thought an outrage had happened to her. Left looking for a Bobby, didn't say if he'd go or not, but I did tell him the woman was dead. So either Robert Paul or Charles Cross seems to not be quite telling the truth.
Indeed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we have an Officer Meisen mentioned, not evil.
Yeah, what's up with that?
Interesting. Lots of things suddenly not connecting where they should be.
Where do we find this Officer Meisen?
M-I-Z-E-N.
Sounds like a bad guy.
There's a Z in the name. That's suspicious.
He's in here. Jonas Meisen.
Shall we?
Let's do it.
At 126E.
You'll have to give Fieldy that book.
Yeah. So you can take it first.
And the skull.
Where was he?
126E. Mm-hmm.
Listen.
Okay.
I don't know who at the yard is sending you, but I'd like not having to endlessly repeat the same things. With sigh, Jonas Meisen unwillingly remembers the night of the murder. I was patrolling on Hanbury when at the crossing with Old Montague, two carters stopped me. One of them told me my services were required at Bucks Row, and after receiving a bit more information, I left in that direction. I found another officer there, Neil, with locals. I helped as much as I could at the moment. I went to fetch the medical examiner, and once the body was transported, I returned home. That's all.
No mention of vagrants. It sounds like he went right over. Starting to think the newspaper account is really suspicious all of a sudden. Although, I want to know what Neil thinks, because Neil apparently got there first.
Yeah.
Yep.
How did Neil get there first? I guess he was just on patrol?
Perfectly reasonable.
John Neal is at 123E.
You want to read another one?
Yep.
It's right there. That was a shorty.
You know who else is a shorty?
Me! Polo! And Polo! 123.
What?
We wake Officer John Neal as he is recovering from a long night shift. Sorry.
Like, we all just walk into his room, like the seven of us.
Hello,
and just like,
wake up, please.
Hey. Come on, hey.
It's time to make breakfast.
Hey.
Sorry, Mr. Neal, apologizes Wiggins, but we'll only take a few minutes. We follow Officer Neal into his modest apartment. He sits down, smooths his mustache, and tries to put some order to his messy hair. What would you like to know, gentlemen? Just a few details. Could you describe the state the body was in when you found it? That poor woman was lying on her back alongside a wooden door with her left side against it and her throat slit. As I didn't see much blood, I took a bit of time to realize she was dead. I even tried to pull her back up. How was it that you didn't see more blood? Wiggins asked, surprised. I first thought that she had been killed elsewhere and dropped off there, so I looked for wheel marks with the light of my lantern, but I found none. Then colleagues arrived, then Dr. Llewellyn, who lives not too far off on Whitechapel Road. The doctor quickly examined the body, then had it transported to the morgue in a hand-pulled cart. It's when we lifted the corpse to put it in the wooden shell that we realized there was a mass of coagulated blood at head height, and that the victim's clothes were largely soaked in it. You didn't see anyone as you arrived. I was making my round from Baker's Road to Brady Street, and no, I didn't see anyone.
Baker's Row.
So none of the other people saw that her throat was slit.
So one thing, didn't Charles Cross say she was on her back?
That's what I thought, yeah.
Yeah, and this had her against the door. It's almost like they found her. Here's a theory. The two guys found her. Mm-hmm. She was okay. They were going to get the officer before Neil arrives, and definitely before they get back. Mm-hmm. She's murdered in that brief window.
Yeah.
And then propped up.
And the newspaper account is the other guy deciding he wants to kind of make himself seem more interesting and grand than he was. He reports it as a murder after he finds out later that she was actually killed. Like he found the dead body instead of the living one.
Right.
Which we can resolve that maybe by talking to him.
Yeah, I think we'd have to...
We need to hear what he has to say.
Otherwise he just didn't want to seem
suspicious.
Where did
all the coagulated blood come from?
Yeah, that's weird.
That's true.
Remember, her neck was ripped open.
Well,
so if she her, if
but then it should have been fresh if she was murdered in between that window, right?
Hmm.
I wonder how blood acts if it's exposed and like it's cold.
I think it still takes a while.
Yeah, and it was soaked through her whole outfit.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
What if it wasn't the same woman?
It's possible.
Because the Carters wouldn't have known her necessarily. The Carters were probably never consulted, and it said either the newspaper or the police report that it took considerable effort to confirm her identity. So she wasn't easily identified.
But didn't it say that she was like so slashed up that it was like hard to identify her?
I don't know if they specified why it was hard to identify her, but they just said after considerable effort.
I would assume that would be more because she's just not well known.
Yeah.
Well, it makes sense because also
we saw her face. Like, her face is...
Yeah, the only injury she has is she's her throat.
Well, didn't they say someone was eviscerated?
My goodness, they did say that, didn't they?
Yeah.
But...
I guess that just...
Well, she had blood in her underwear too, right?
Yes, that's right. Maybe they're just sidestepping that for the sake of the decency of the story, because I always thought that the story of Jack the Ripper was that he, like, slashed up their abdomens pretty good.
Yeah, which would be eviscerated.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can we go back and look at our autopsy clue again, to see if we can try and...
I think that's...
Put some pieces...
But no, that makes sense because...
Oh, the autopsy, was that the morgue, or...?
That was at the morgue, yes, yeah. Which 24E. Is... Yeah.
24E. Yeah, because also that would make sense for the rigor mortis setting in sooner.
Also, I'm also curious if the new bonnet has anything to do with anything. Or
well, there was a bonnet on the ground that Charles Cross noted.
Yes.
Description of the clothes, is that what we're looking for? Or?
Or just, I just kind of want to, yeah.
Description of the body, I guess.
Because we know that he had the throat was slashed. Because she wouldn't have been breathing if the throat was, well, unless it was, yeah.
Yeah,
I think if she was, like, still different. Alive with a slashed throat, it would be very obvious that she was dying.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, they wouldn't have reported still breathing, certainly.
Yeah.
There isn't a whole lot describing the body. The body of a woman in her 40s, partially covered by a great... A drape stained with brown spots, her head with hair slicked down by blood is tilted back, her eyes closed for eternity. Gaping gash holds her throat open. And then there's a description of the clothes.
What about, and this might be too obvious to be correct, but sometimes that's the way it goes.
Right.
Charles Cross discovers her passed out in the alleyway, calls Robert Paul over, discovers that she's passed out but still alive. And then they say, oh, we need to go get the cops.
Yep.
Charles Cross goes to get Officer Mizzen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Robert Paul kills her. Then Officer... What is the order of Officer Neil and Officer Mizzen?
Neil was there first.
Okay. So Neil is on patrol, right?
Yeah. Neil showed up on his own.
Right. So Paul gets scarce. Neil shows up. Mizzen comes back. Paul gives them the story of, oh yeah, she was dead when we found her because he killed her.
But did Charles say that Robert went with him to find the police?
I thought not. We can take another look at
it. They went together part of the way and they split up eventually.
Oh, interesting.
But,
they went their own ways.
We can confirm that timeline.
Yeah.
Pitford's is 98 EC if we want to double check it.
Really, to be...
Is a bonnet different from, like... Didn't they say she was wearing, like, a brim tat or something like that?
With, like, lace. They said there was a bonnet on the ground.
I thought it was a bonnet.
Yeah, it's a bonnet, I think.
And she said she had found a funny new bonnet or whatever. There was her bonnet on the ground next to her. Thought she was drunk. Went over to see what happened. At that point, I hear footsteps. I turned around. It was Robert, another Carter. So I call him over to come and see. I touch the woman's hand. She's cold. I then tell Robert that she must be dead to check... Places his hand on her chest, tells me she's still breathing. She was all askew, her skirt raised to her waist. We thought she'd been outraged. We covered her up and left to get the police. We found an officer, Mizen was his name was, who was making his rounds at the corner of Hanbury and Old Montague. We told him what we had discovered on Bucks Row. Then we headed straight to work, Robert and I, by going along Hanbury Street. We split up a bit before Commercial Street, since Robert works at Corbett's Court.
So those two left her there together, and then the officer, Neil, was the next person to get there?
Neil showed up before Mizen, yeah.
Yeah, but the Robert and Charles stayed together for a considerable period, it seems like.
Yeah, I guess so.
The officer should have arrived, at least one of the officers would have probably arrived first on the timeline, I think. But at the very least, Mizen, because he was going directly there, Robert had to stay with Charles based on this report for some time before he could have split off to go back, and I don't think he went back.
Unless they're both in on it.
Yeah.
Like,
definitely
they found the...
It could also be that she was dead, and Paul knew that, and lied about the fact that she was still breathing.
Indeed.
But then who propped her up next to the door?
Let's see if we can find Robert and talk to him, because he's got some explaining.
We know where he works based on that.
He also lives at 5E.
What day is it? I guess he would...
Well, if he's a Carter, too, then he might be at work since the other guy was.
True.
In case we need that.
One of those dopey ones
Yeah. He's at work, you dummy!
Yeah, because they were both going to work, and one was at work, so it seems reasonable. Of course, if he's not at work, that almost might be interesting, too.
True.
Yeah, we really can't afford one of those.
What if he's outside looking at blood?
Polo, no!
I would probably say we should go to Corbett's Court.
I think that's a good idea.
Just because it's a clue that's in a lead or whatever.
Yes, indeed.
Mm-hmm.
What was that one?
Corbett's Court. It's Robert's workplace.
Oh.
And to play, metagame man for a moment. That's something we learned, not just directly through the paper.
So. Yeah, that's true too.
If we went to his house,
yeah, they would not assume that we necessarily knew we had a reason to suspect him.
How's Corbett spelled?
Corbett.
So there's two people named Corbett. There's.
Did you look in the businesses?
I did.
Oh.
It's a Carter. What would that be under? Do you have anything? Synagogues? Prisons? Mm-hmm.
transportation, I have to imagine.
Just look at all the C's. That's what I usually do.
Cycles.
Also, is it on the map somewhere?
Yeah, maybe.
And then they say they walk all the way down Whitechapel Street.
Yes, and then they split up on some street, right? Corbett's Court. It's a street.
Oh, I see. It said, we split up a bit before Commercial Street, since Robert works at Corbett's Court.
So
49 or 46.
I think we can give ourselves a gimme on that.
49 is a bigger building.
Let's try 49E first.
And then
that's true. If there's absolutely nothing there, it'll just bounce. It doesn't count.
Right. Or if it's an obvious red herring.
Yeah.
Sherlock's not
nothing
here.
Nothing there.
Sherlock's not going to catch us.
About 46.
There is 46, but it's very small. We go to Corbett's Court looking for the man named Robert, and we're told that there is a carter with that name working here, Robert Paul, but that he took a few days off to rest.
Go to his home?
I'm going to say that's a... Whoops, that didn't happen.
Yeah, there's certainly no video evidence of it.
No.
He lives at 5E.
Hey, if Push says we can cheat.
Yeah. 5E. 5E. Robert Paul lives in a modest apartment on Forsyth Street with his pregnant wife and his four children. I was on the way to work when I saw another carter in Bucks Row, and we discovered the body. I wanted to move it, but the other man thought we had better not. So then I put her clothes back. We couldn't leave the poor woman like that. That's when I touched her, and I thought I felt her breathe. We left to look for a policeman. We met Officer Meisen before going on our way. Work was waiting for us. I went back to see the police the next day to make a statement.
We never went to,
Never mentioned going to the newspaper.
Well, I assume the statement in the paper, I assume the report in the paper is based on the statement.
We didn't go to,
Can we talk to the doctor who did the autopsy?
But he just brazenly admits to us that he just brazenly tells us something very different than was in the paper, if that's what he told the police.
Well, the paper may have also embellished. Yes, speaking to the doctor might be a good idea.
Yeah. Or we could talk to the people who write the paper. Is that an option?
We could.
I like talking to the doctor first.
Yeah.
Me too.
There is also Wynn Baxter, the coroner for the case, who we might be able to talk to.
Robert Paul Carter has stated this to our reporter.
Right.
Yeah, it definitely says he spoke to a reporter.
Interesting.
Yeah, but...
Yeah.
I mean...
The reporter might have been at the station when he went there or something.
Yes, that's absolutely true. Yeah.
But the, what I find interesting... is the one thing that I did notice from his statement is that it sounded like they put her like clothes back in a more decent state.
Right.
And
if they were soaked in blood, wouldn't they?
They should have noticed that if they touched her clothing.
Yeah, then they would. They would be soaked in blood also. Even if it was dry, like they would still be like, oh, weird, there is some blood on my hands.
Well, it was down their back. That's true.
And I assume this is...
Just moving her skirt down might not have been that bad.
Especially since there were so many layers.
It's one of those things, when they keep telling us it was too dark to see blood, then I think that's one of those things we have to assume, okay, they couldn't see blood.
Right.
Yes.
So we've tripped over that before in the past.
Right.
Questioning there.
Yeah, talking to the doctor that actually examined her might be a good idea.
I like that idea.
Shall I?
Yeah. Although, the thing about the too dark to see blood is when that officer showed up with a lantern.
Yeah, he specifically had a way around that.
And he still didn't notice it at first.
Well, it was on her back primarily, right?
Yeah.
This fellow is...
I think she must have been still on her back when she was killed for it to rush back. for it to like go back. Otherwise, it would come all the way down her front.
Yeah. Specifically, when they talk, when we went to one of the details from the not autopsy is that her hair was soaked in it.
Yes.
Which seems to mean that like when her throat was slit, that yeah, she was like lying down. Mm. I would assume.
Yeah, I assume she passed out there, and then whoever did it, like, found her there, or had been following her. How do I keep losing this? 115E.
Egypt.
Dr. Llewellyn lets us into his room, but doesn't seem all that disposed to grant us much of his time. He's a stern man in the prime of his years, wearing a short beard. The walls of the waiting room in which he receives us are plastered with frames, containing his degrees and honorary titles. Diploma of Higher Medical Studies from the London Hospital, Division Doctor's Title from Her Majesty's Armies, manuscript page making him a member of the British Gynecological Society. I've already made many statements to the press and to the police, and my report was sent to St. Bartholomew's Hospital, as the doctor explains to us in tired voice. If you want to read it, you will need to go there. We won't bother you for long, Doctor, answers Wiggins. We'd just like to know if you noticed anything peculiar, if you could clarify two or three things, such as the approximate time of Marianne Nichols' death, and the cause of death, and if you could tell us if she'd been killed elsewhere and dropped off at Bucks Row later. Listen, I got there around 4 o'clock. We're only 300 yards from Bucks Row, and Marianne Nichols was dead. Her wrists were cold, but her body was still warm. She had been dead for at least half an hour, and it's of course out of the question that the wound could have been self-inflicted. There was very little blood around the neck and on the ground. Blood must have flowed into her hair, into her clothes. Not that there was not a lot of blood, but that it wasn't on the ground. As to the cause of death, the wounds to her abdomen as well as to those of her throat are sufficient to cause death. We just need to determine in which order they were made. I think the victim first had her throat slashed, then was gutted once lying down. I ordered the body be transported to the Whitechapel morgue rather than morgue of Whitechapel Hospice. Short time later, I joined them to perform the autopsy. The rest is in my report.
So she was dead at 3:30, according to that.
Yeah.
And they found her at 3:45, and both have said, yeah, she was breathing. Starting to have a funny theory about there being two women here. Like, they found someone other than her. Mm-hmm. So here's my crazy theory. We're going to kind of scribble it down. Mm-hmm. So you have... you have Marianne Nichols.
Yep.
With her bonnet. Comes along.
Yep.
She gets snatched. Her bonnet drops on the ground. Someone else comes along. The woman that is found by the Carters. She's drunk and just kind of passes out. They go to find a police officer. She recovers and wanders off, and the body of the original woman is deposited back where she was taken from, bloody and messed up. The only thing it doesn't explain is the coagulated blood that was on the ground.
Yeah.
Hmm. I mean, she couldn't have been, she couldn't have been breathing at 3:45 if she was dead at 3:30. Unless both of the Carters are lying to us about that.
I mean, maybe they are.
Yeah, that's possible. But we need to be able to prove that somehow.
Is it worth visiting St. Bartholomew's to read the full report?
Where's that?
It's hard to imagine what we'd learn that's more important than that she was alive at 3:30.
True.
That's a pretty big one. There were some other related cases mentioned.
Oh, that's true. I forgot about this.
One about Smith in particular, but we need to read the police station entry again to see.
I think Lestrade was following those up. There's a separate entry for Lestrade, the book.
Yeah. Normal value for blood clotting time is 8 to 15 minutes.
Oh, well, then it actually easily could have coagulated in that window of time.
How about that?
So...
I feel like there's a side story about that fire/explosion going on in here. Cause didn't they say
there's a fire something in there for sure? I remember that.
Like I'm I'm starting to think it doesn't have much to do with this, but I do keep notes.
Bonus points.
Like, seizure of explosives, explosion at the Guinness Brewery, and someone was watching a fire.
Wasn't that in... That's in Dublin.
Oh. Yeah. Never mind.
Where they make Guinness.
That makes a lot of sense.
But we could go through all the stuff.
Journalist at the Police Gazette. Journalist at the London Times. You might know who gave that crazy
report.
Well, it says he's usually for foreign affairs.
Yeah.
Although it says... Oh, that's interesting. Does the London Times have a different address than him?
Okay, there's the bar at the docks. So that makes more sense.
I mean, I don't... Okay. It doesn't need to sit in a particular spot. Okay, well, we could follow up with Lestrade on similar cases. We could... We still haven't visited the scene of the crime.
Yeah.
We could try and take a shot at that.
How many meters it is from...
We could also talk to the coroner assigned to the case. Which is not the guy that we just spoke with.
Right. Wynn Baxter.
Right. I think that might be worthwhile.
We definitely want to go to the scene at some
point. Yeah.
We can narrow it down.
So are we thinking that the two people that found him are...
I think it must be... innocent. It must be this one, because it seems like their route should have been walking down Whitechapel Road.
It is called the horror at Whitechapel, and this building is the one that's on
Whitechapel
Road.
Station construction site.
She's up against a door?
She was propped up against
wouldn't
a door
worry.
At a later point in the proceedings.
Mm-hmm. I'd say...
It may have been, like, between these buildings or anything.
Yeah, I'm thinking we look at 102E to see if that's it.
Oh!
Yeah.
It's you!
The one who is moving now.
It is E102.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's the robot from Sonic Adventure. E102 Gamma.
Oh! It was like, Chow's? What?
That lead is free, don't count it. The construction site of the Whitechapel train station is crawling with workers by day, but it is deserted by nightfall. You can find no one to tell us about the murder on Bucks Row. This lead is free. Don't count it. So I want to go to 2E.
Yes.
It's nice that they do that.
Yeah. Okay. It must mean they have no way. They don't actually tell you exactly which one to go to.
Yeah. All right. 2E. We have a bit more here. Bucks Row is a sordid street that runs along the East London Railway Line train track. It is bordered on one side by two stony houses with rotting roofs. The walls are kept away from the 8-yard-wide street by pavement barely 3 feet wide. On the other side, the walls of the Schneider's Cap Factory must, at night, plunge the street into darkness much more sinister than its ambiance in daytime would ever suggest. We look for the place where the body of Mary Ann Nichols was discovered. In the deserted alley, near a school, we notice traces of dried blood at the foot of the door of a horse butcher's warehouse. A large, round, dark mark is found on the ground near the left side of the door. Wiggins attempts to push the door without success. We canvass the area and first meet Emma Green, a widow who lives with her daughter and her two grandsons in the little house next to the stables, in front of which the body of Mary Ann Nichols was found. "My room and my daughter's overlook the pavement where the poor woman was found," the old woman explains to us. I didn't hear anything until the arrival of the police, yet I'm a very light sleeper. Across the street, we meet Walter Perkins, the director of the Essex Loading Dock, who lives close to here with his wife and his son. Our room is on the second floor of the fishmonger's and overlooks the street. I went to bed around 11 and woke up many times during the night, between 1 and 3. My wife also slept very badly, yet the night was particularly calm. She was even pacing the room at around 3:30 as she told the policeman. Neither one of us heard anything other than the noise of the trains.
Interesting. It seems to sound like she wasn't killed there.
Right. Yeah, it lends credence to the idea that she was killed somewhere else and dropped off.
Yet not in a heavy cart that would make sound.
Yeah, how would she be transported so easily? She would have to be killed inside one of the buildings, I guess, and brought outside?
Maybe.
Can investigate the place where she was seen last, 230 Osborne in Whitechapel, across the street from a church.
The,
it was
horse butcher, it seems like. Is there some significance to that in terms of being a building where you could find unpleasant implements? Well, however.
Well, they made a point of him pushing on the door, but not getting in for some reason. Just that it wouldn't be an easily accessible place, maybe? I don't know.
Might have just been locked.
Yeah. Where's Osborne in Whitechapel? All right, is that what this is?
Yep, that's the Zambambo.
Yeah, so 2 minutes, and they talked there.
Where she saw Nelly, or?
Yeah, that's where she saw Nelly. Didn't Nelly say the church bell tolled?
Yes.
Yeah, so that'd be 3 o'clock.
Yep.
So they were there until 3 o'clock. She died, we think, at 3:30.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
She wandered off into the dark.
But according to this, I mean, granted, that's travel speed. It doesn't have to be limited to walking speed. According to this, she could have been taken anywhere, killed anywhere, and then brought there by 3:30.
Where was the boarding house where we talked to Nelly? Boba Fett.
18E.
Oh, I see. If I rotate my head around here. And knock over my head, don't worry. That building says manure works, doesn't it?
Yes. Next to the Jewish cemetery.
And, well, here's the end of the tracks.
Where's that?
This is the end of the rail tracks.
Hmm. Well, there's no number there, so we can't investigate it.
No, I know. I'm just trying to get a mental picture of where this dark shadow is. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing like this is the like super thin street, you know, they're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
I guess all the people we talked to are in this spot number 2 here.
Here's a thing. It was pouring rain that night.
All right, cats and also pillow.
Right.
Hmm.
So
it would have washed away.
It would have washed away, like
a lot of the blood that wasn't coagulated.
Exactly. Yeah.
Potentially. Yeah.
I think we should investigate here because I think she was abducted.
Yeah.
Somewhere around there.
That's what's starting to seem like a thing.
You said across from the chapel, so that would be like one of these.
We could try the chapel. Chapel might have had someone in it.
The chapel is red.
Yeah.
This says,
I'm wondering.
A matter by luck around 2:30 in the morning at the corner of Osborne Street and Whitechapel Road across from the church.
So
13 or 59.
13 or 65.
13 or 65, that's E?
Yes, I was reading the number upside down.
Yes. 13 or 65, E.
Yep.
We'll try 13 first. Swing and a miss. What was the next number?
65.
59.
65E, swing and a miss.
Alright, let's do the church then.
I guess so, yeah.
It is 89.
89.
Like I said.
I know.
89.
That's not what I said.
89E, swing and a miss.
89E,
right?
Maybe no one else saw her. It's not really anyone to talk to.
Okay, she arrived at that location drunk. Maybe there's a bar somewhere in that neighborhood that we can track down.
Yeah.
And then the frying pan is the one that she was known to be at earlier.
Ah, that's right. We haven't checked that out.
That was around 12:30.
That's 17E.
And that was before she went to that's, Wall Street.
Yeah, that's not
the
that.
Frying pan is
over. It's right across the street from Boba Fett.
Yeah, that's...
I wouldn't mind.
Yeah, she got drunk at 17 and then went to the shelter to try and sleep. And he got.
But then she made more money and got more drunk.
Mm-hmm. But did she get drunk there or somewhere else? Is there a closer... There's here's a...
Angel and Crown sounds like a bar.
Yeah.
Let's double check that with the directory. You're absolutely correct. It is.
What's this one here?
Star and Plow.
That is also an inn, so... think either of those is worth a try. Also, there was another thing that we had remarked upon. Nelly mentioned the protection of the Nelson gang, I think.
Yeah, what does that mean?
I don't know. Presumably,
as opposed to the white gang?
No.
To the Bobbies.
The cops.
Presumably, they run things around here.
Right.
As it happens, I was reminded of it by the fact that there is a Nelson Tavern, which is 114E. Which is all the way on the other side of town. I mean, this is only like 15 minutes away.
Yeah, that's weird. It's like 115 to 118 before.
113.
Must be important.
Okay. Yeah.
That says Dutfield's Yard.
What? Maybe that's just the block.
I will say, the taverns around here, I feel like I can kind of metagaming a little, disqualify the frying pan because you would know about that before you were.
Yes, absolutely.
This, where was she headed? Like, why was she walking down?
Well, she may have been taken that way too. We don't.
Well, she said she walked off into the darkness. Yeah. If she wasn't going back she was walking to sleep, up where was she going?
Ultimately.
Well, she was going, remember, to. She needed to earn more money, yeah. So maybe she knew she could turn a trick that way.
Sure.
Let's try Angel and Crown.
Which.
I guess that's.
Sorry, just a moment. What's this?
That is
Working Lads Institute.
What is that?
That was mentioned.
Sounds like a place where boys go to get a job. Or, like, I don't know.
I did hear it mentioned, I just don't remember when.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's London's YMCA, maybe. yeah.
Thank you. I wonder if, perhaps she headed that way to make the rest of the money that she was trying to make that night.
Looking for some boys?
Maybe, yeah. What is that word above it?
Anchor.
Anchor?
So wait, just to clarify, how do we know she was headed this way?
She could have been headed the other way, but I thought
yes,
she's...
that's true. That's true. She was headed towards... Whitechapel. No, that's why we know. She said specifically she was headed towards Whitechapel Road. Whitechapel Road doesn't turn into Whitechapel Road until this side of the map.
Okay. Interesting. Okay, I wish I could remember where the Working Lab Institute was mentioned. I feel like I've heard of it before.
I don't remember
hearing that mentioned.
Maybe I saw it in the newspaper.
You have the newspaper?
I do.
Can I see this?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Can we talk to the person who wrote the newspaper report? Is that in there? You guys don't think it's a...
It doesn't say who wrote it. The only contact we have for the London paper says he specializes in foreign affairs.
Mm.
Yeah, I don't really know. Like, that
That's
might...
Fair enough.
Yeah.
This afternoon at the Working Lads Institute, Whitechapel Road, Mr. Wynn E. Baxter will open an investigation into the death of the unfortunate woman in presence of the police authorities.
That's it.
Represented by Lestrade and Eberlein.
I feel like that might
okay.
be a relevant place to visit.
All of a sudden, I'm feeling the YM lab A.
All right, that's 10E.
Yeah.
I replaced the wrong letters in that.
Sounded fine to me.
10E. This isn't your lucky day, his secretary explains to us. Mr. Baxter just left for the morgue, furious that two residents have removed the victim's clothes before the arrival of the medical examiner next expertise. Knowing Mr. Baxter and how persnickety he is, I wouldn't want to be in those two shoes. And Inspector Aberdeen, asked Wiggins? I can't tell you. I know he usually floats between Commercial Street and here. He's a difficult man to catch right now.
Well, we already went to the morgue.
Yes.
And Commercial Street.
Which means we may want to try and corner him at home.
Yeah. Were we unable to talk to the other man who worked at the morgue?
I don't think we made a swing at that.
No, they just mentioned him.
Yeah, we didn't try him out.
Confess, I'm not too interested in that guy at the moment. I feel like we've got a lot of other much bigger things to do.
Yeah, I feel like the condition of the body isn't the unknown.
I love someone who knew what happened after this.
It seems weird that those two guys would remove the clothes of a murder victim,
They weren't shy about admitting that they'd done.
Well, they said they seemed very non-interested. Like they do this all the time, so they're just another one. Just do it.
Remember, this is atypical for that location. They don't usually do this at that place.
That's true. Yeah, they were inexperienced.
We want to look more into Robert and and Cross, potentially, or do we think it's just somebody else that did a swap or did the deed in between them finding her?
I don't have any better idea who, but it doesn't seem like they're either of them have given away anything that suggests that they did it.
The tavern's nearby.
Something that may not be a relevant detail, but given the abdomen injuries and such like that, it seems. I'm wondering if the fact that they had to cut up the clothes to take them off is obscuring the ways in which the body was actually cut. Like, that's obfuscating that. You would expect the clothing to be cut. Oh, unless that's the whole reason they've... Yeah.
Right.
And the doctor said what the cuts were anyway.
Yeah.
Well, the taverns nearby are the Angel and Crown, is that correct?
Yeah, 82 and...
82 and...
73.
Yeah.
This one was an inn, I think?
Oh.
Well, that's the same thing.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Oh,
yep.
Try Angel and Crown if there's no objections. Hopefully better than most of the NBA.
Hopefully there's more than one paragraph.
Yes. And that's E, right?
82. Yep.
E. Ooh. The Angel and Crown is an old animated tavern with large banisters from which clients located on
like with arms and legs.
All equipped with pewter mugs can observe those remaining downstairs while talking and laughing loudly. We're looking for Maisie Heckle, but she's the one who finds us. Over here, we'll be left alone, she whispers as she pulls Wiggins by the arm in the direction of the dark corner under the banister.
Sorry, does anyone know who Maisie Heckle is?
Nope.
Oh, I think we may have random guessed ourselves into into something obscure. Do we want to back out, or...?
Nope, you got
no,
it.
Okay. I want information.
Okay. I'm sorry, Maria.
Yes, we're here to see you.
I should have used more tact. I hope we didn't put you in an embarrassing situation. No, it's okay. It could have been worse. John, my companion, knows nothing about my old life, and I'd rather remain that way. I'd like to leave all of that behind me. Wiggins explains to her the reason for our visit, but would you explain it to me?
Well, it sounds like this is a former working girl who has escaped the life somehow.
Yeah. Let's see, and Maisie Heckle tells us her story. At the time, I was earning my keep and paying my rent by prostituting myself, as I was all alone. Then I met John and tried to change my path, but at first I had trouble finding money each night to pay for
it. We found some money!
Yay.
What? Zavatek donated $100!
Yeah. Thank you!
Zavatek. Thank you!
That's amazing!
My goodness. Can't stick around, but good luck, Foxhound, with life, and good luck, crew, finding the moon, or whatever has been happening. Zabu, thank you so much. That's amazing. You're literally helping me buy groceries. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Zabu.
Polo, we can eat today. We don't have to sell our bodies for pennies. Oh, no, that's not funny. Working sex people are real people, too. Sex people. Sex Boy. Workers is
the, oh my goodness.
Would you like a shovel? You can dig that hole a little faster.
Can you pass me the crowbar? I seem to have both feet in my mouth.
Indeed.
Thank you.
Let's see.
Anyway, back to this poor prostitute story.
It's gonna get a lot worse real fast.
Dark packs.
We're there, friends. When I settled down with John, I realized that I had gotten pregnant. I wasn't even sure he was the father, so I wanted to abort. I knew a girl, Emma she was called, who had had hers removed. She was older and said at the time that it wasn't very proper to be pregnant at her age. I asked her for the address of the midwife she'd given. She gave it to me and even told me that thanks to her boyfriend, she could get me a deal. I think that Emma and her man would get money when they brought her a patient, and that the midwife really didn't get a say in it if she didn't want to get reported to the police. I went to see her, and coming out, three young men stopped me, wanting to know where Freddie Broken Fingers and Emma were. I told them that I had no clue, so their leader threw me to the ground and told me that if I didn't talk then, he'd be the one aborting me. He told me...
What? Jiminy crickets.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Like I said, it's gonna get worse. He told me that he didn't like little songbirds like me and that Freddie and Emma would pay for what they were doing. Then, encouraged by his friends, he hit me, then pulled out a billy club while telling me I'd better tell them where he was holed up. Thankfully, people alerted by the noise got them to scamper. His friends managed to flee, but he was held by passerby long enough for policemen to arrive. After that, I went to the hospital where I had a stillborn.
What the fuck? Should we...
The midwife, could you give us her name and tell us where she lives? Maisie Hackle stares at us nervously, then decides to answer us. She's French. She's called Martine Lejeune.
Lejeune? Lejeune. Finally, some lightheartedness.
And lived in Hunt Street, but she went back to France.
Well,
that seems like...
Gave me a lot more questions than...
That seems what like is bonus quest.
Oh, here's her address.
Yeah, we stumbled into something ahead of time, perhaps, but definitely a lot to it.
Is that talking about the gang, though?
I feel like that's probably if we had followed up more on...
The gang, we might have some...
Well, maybe on the gang, I was thinking more like Polly's history, like her old boyfriend or something like that. Maybe we've discovered something to do with that.
What was his name?
I was interested in finding more about Thomas. She had a crush on Thomas the Smith.
Right.
But
do we have a last name?
Because so many of these stories have been about like crimes of passion or something. But
yeah, this feels a lot more cold and calculated.
Yeah.
The whole movie body thing.
Yeah.
So here's another thing that we haven't quite brought up yet, and that I hadn't wanted to indulge quite so much because a lot of the Jack the Ripper lore kind of revolves around it already. But to like carve someone up and like take their guts out requires maybe some medical knowledge. So maybe we want to like focus on some kind of a lead that like someone that has that kind of skill set.
Like someone who works at a butcher shop or something.
I mean, a butcher.
Like a doctor.
Butcher.
Yeah, maybe more like a butcher or a surgeon or something like that. Someone maybe with more. You know, because a butcher will certainly like pull out the entrails and stuff like that, but they're not as precise.
What was this?
Necessarily precise? We haven't had that implied yet.
It wasn't precise necessarily, but I mean, they. I imagine that it.
It's not easy to pull out someone's inside.
Yeah, and on top of which, to do so in such a way that doesn't like get blood everywhere.
Right.
Though considering it was raining.
Yes, that's true.
Cleaned things up.
Especially if it was done outside. Mm. In which case, where are the entrails?
Were they removed? I mean, do we know
that? A different bowel.
I thought she was.
Might have more detail.
That's true. The St. Bart's report.
Yeah.
Yes, we need that.
I think we should go there.
Let's go.
Hospitals.
For Meeks, right?
38 EC, yeah. Maybe our old pal Jasper will have something to say. Man, this is a grisly story. I hope the rest.
That one was pretty brutal.
I hope the rest of the Jack the Murder stories are way better.
A little less murdery, maybe?
Yeah.
After having...
Maybe he just, like, stole a car.
Yeah. A
car. So that's why they call it a carjacking.
Oh my word.
Could you be, like, a little bit more serious, please?
The gravity
in
here.
Oh, get him.
No! Don't get Brandon's blood. He needs that. Please take us to the hospital.
Paul is a vampire now.
After having found the office of the head medical examiner empty, we go down to the basement of St. Bartholomew's Hospital, looking for the autopsy room. To our great surprise, we stumble upon a group made up of four workers and a dozen young women, accompanied by children, who, while eating chips from old newspaper cones, contemplate through a glass window seven bodies exposed to the gaze of all on inclined tables of black marble.
This is excellent.
Why?
I'm with Brandon. Are we in Yarnath?
The bodies are bare and wetted by rivulets of water coming from faucets located over each of the tables. Evidently, none of the visitors has come here to identify anyone. Suddenly, Sir Jasper Meeks rushes into the room and starts frog marching this little crowd towards the exit. I'm sick of these Sunday strollers who come to the morgue as if it was a day at the zoo. How can I assist?
Well, the zoos have recently had their crocodile population depleted.
You can't go to the zoo to see lions anymore. Yeah. Or lions, yeah. Lions are gone.
Wiggins tells him we're investigating the crime which took place in Buck's Row, a certain Mary Nichols. I was actually in the middle of rereading Llewellyn's report. If you knew what a mess. Two residents couldn't think of anything better to do than strip and clean that poor woman before Llewellyn's passage.
Yep.
Oh yeah, we're talking about the, yeah. The imbeciles, can you explain to me why they didn't start off by bringing the body to me here? Their morgue is no more than a quick stop on the way to a mass grave. Sure, the hospital is a bit further away, but bloody hell, it's clear that this is an unusual crime which requires the greatest of attentions. Seeing what little information I have, my conclusions can't be much different from Llewellyn's. Sir Jasper then reads us his colleague's report. This is a woman in poor condition, 5'3", round, roughly 43 years of age, 5 teeth are missing, a slight laceration on the tongue. Any marks or blows? Asks Wiggins. Meeks ignores him and continues his lecture. A bruise on the lower part of the jaw, on the right side of the face. This could be the result of pressure from a thumb. We can also notice a round contusion on the left side of the face, which could have been inflicted by the pressure of many fingers. Due to being strangled, asked Wiggins. No after, Meeks answers dryly. They're almost at cheek level. I concur with Llewellyn that they're post-mortem. Meeks continues his lecture. On the left side of the neck, we can observe an incision starting directly under the ear and extending as far as an inch under the jaw. On the same side, but almost an inch lower, is the start of a circular incision, when ends 3 inches under the right jaw. This incision completely tore all tissues to the vertebrae. We must wonder if he didn't try to decapitate her, Wiggins exclaims. Meeks continues his lecture in a neutral tone. No blood on the chest, nor on the body, or on the clothes. No blood on the clothes. But her dress should have been stained with blood, Wiggins asks. If she had been standing, surely, but I doubt it, comments Meeks before resuming. No other wounds on the body until we come to the lower part of the abdomen. To the left, we find a large incision which tore the flesh. Many more incisions crisscross the abdomen. On the right side, 3 or 4 blows are identical and go from top to bottom. The blows were delivered from left to right and could be the work of a left-hand person. All wounds were caused by a long-bladed knife, moderately sharpened and used with great violence. The report ends here. Which of these wounds caused the death? That's the whole question, Wiggins. It's a point of divergence between Llewellyn and I. He believes that the cause of death was due to the evisceration of the victim, or the deep wound that slit her throat. In my opinion, this poor woman was strangled first. At what time was she killed? I can't tell you precisely, as her temperature wasn't taken on location. Nonetheless, the body was still warm when it was discovered, and Llewellyn noticed no signs of rigor mortis. She must have been discovered roughly an hour after having been killed. Unlike what you said earlier, your conclusions seem to differ from Llewellyn's. Listen, gentlemen, I don't have the habit of throwing discredit on a colleague, not having been on the crime scene. However, I can't hide that some of his observations seem erroneous to me.
Hmm.
He did it.
Meeks.
Yep.
Put him away.
It was Sherlock Holmes, the detective.
Let's see. There's still the related cases that were being looked into.
Yes, that's so.
We're down to 3 leads left, too.
I confess, I don't feel like we're really narrowing it down to anyone. But maybe we don't need to have that. I mean, we're expecting that because of the other things that we've had to do.
Yeah, a 4-part campaign.
Yes, I regret to announce that we will not catch Jack the Ripper tonight.
Yeah.
But maybe we're just trying to provide some information in exchange for Sherlock points.
Indeed.
Well, talking to Lestrade might be a good idea.
Indeed.
I'm definitely... Like, so, I feel like the, it's weird.
What's that?
Like, if they were strangled first.
If she was dead first, that would reduce the blood flow from future injuries, presumably.
She could have still.
Well, why would she be propped up on the door?
Well, if she was strangled first, that wouldn't have made any noise.
Right, yeah. I definitely feel like the strangulation accounts for the silence.
So what if... Yes, what if she was... What if he strangled her and then slashed her up?
And thought she was dead?
Then thought she was dead or got interrupted by the Carters arriving on the scene.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They check her, think she's still alive, rush off to get the cop. Then he slashes her throat and props her up.
Yeah.
Or perhaps props her up to slash her.
Yes,
throat.
Yes. But wait.
Well,
I think still slashes her throat.
While she's on the ground, so
because
into her hair.
Yes.
Then why does she get propped up against the door?
Just because.
I'm not sure. But then that conflicts with the whole, like, replacement theory.
Well, it may not have been, it's only a theory, but if she was strangled, I mean, she could have been alive and drunk at that point, and then strangled, and that would keep her quiet for the subsequent slashing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Which, given that she was in no condition to resist because she was drunk and basically passed out, that could be done relatively quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting that the other guy didn't mention the strangulation angle at all. Did he?
I don't think so. I think this is the first we've heard mention of it.
Yeah. That is interesting.
Like that whole morgue operation is the most suspicious thing going on right now.
It is.
Who made the decision to bring it there? Did we ever find out whose call it was to, hey, we're just going to take them to this little crazy...
For like
this,
what was
this,
obviously a big crime
this
scene.
Yeah, and everyone's kind of said, hey, that's a really dumb thing you did.
9 in the morning, the deceased's body was moved to a separate room in the old Montague Street morgue that had been turned into an improvised operating room, and a Dr. Ralph Llewellyn performed the post-mortem examination. And then in here, part of this is said... that's not said. But where did we visit with Mizzen?
Neil? 126E.
I thought we did. Sorry?
126.
Seems like something we would have done.
I'm pretty sure we talked to Neil, didn't we?
Yes.
I went to fetch the medical examiner once the body was transported. I went home. And then where is Neil?
123.
Oh, it's right next to it.
Yeah.
Right. Then colleagues arrived. Then Dr. Llewellyn, who lives not too far off on Whitechapel Road. The doctor quickly examined the body, then had it transported to the morgue in a hand-pulled cart. It's when we lifted the corpse to put it in the wooden shell.
So who called the doctor?
Colleagues, so I assume other cops. So, someone who knows how to disembowel a person is on hand when the cops discover a body. recommends that they move the body to this weird little shady morgue.
That he knows is probably going to make a mess of the affair.
And then doesn't report a key element of how she was killed.
Yeah, and also, one thing. The autopsy didn't happen until like 6-something, right?
That's right, until many hours later.
Yeah, you sent her to a morgue that's like, you know, at most with, you know, 5 minutes away.
It's literally right there.
Not even like a minute away.
Yep.
I'm going to go stroll around for a couple hours before I deal with this.
Yep. Knowing full well that because of the way the place is run, remember the attendant said, we do it this way because the doctor prefers to have it done this way to save me time.
Yeah.
So they knew that if you sent them a body, they would contaminate the body.
Yeah, I'm liking this doctor bad guy theory.
Also, he has too many L's in his name.
Four? That's obscene.
Like, two L's already is all you need to make an X.
He does.
So then there's the story that he had found her stumbling drunk, strangled her,
yes,
and then was being... noticed that Carter was coming around.
Yes.
And so abandons the body.
Mm-hmm.
He finds her. So, same with Robert.
Hides. Then he finishes her off. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. One thing we don't have for the doctor yet is any sort of motive.
He likes to kill people.
All right.
That's why I became a doctor.
Well, maybe we should talk to Lestrade to see if we can find anything else out about these older cases.
Indeed.
See if we can make some kind of connection.
It's not a bad name.
We got three visits left.
Whose turn is it to read? Is it Lobos?
It's mine. I think she's.
I think you're right.
Where is
I think we should try Scotland Yard. Which is of course.
Have this number memorized by now.
We should.
It's 13SW.
Thank you.
13SW. So far away. A police officer leads it to the office of Inspector Lestrade. Listen, answers Lestrade, self-importantly.
You guys again!
I don't have time to talk with you. Head Inspector Donald Swanson, in charge of this case, has demanded swift results, otherwise heads will roll. He delegated the fieldwork search to a so-called specialist of the East End, Inspector Abeline of the CID. With our help, this foul case should presently be resolved. Why do you believe that, Inspector? Asked Wiggins. It's obvious this isn't the first crime that this malfeasant has perpetrated. It's a racket organized by a neighborhood gang which is blackmailing these poor women by promising them an illusory protection. There are many, you know, like the Nichols gang or the Blind Beggar gang. She must have refused to pay and things went sour. The authors of the racket will not remain unnoticed for much longer. Blood flowed this time and fear should untie tongues. I've asked for the files about one death as well as two closed cases, Millwood and Wilson, in addition to a few files of my own. I'm still waiting for this information from both archives, but I'm confident. Were similar cases resolved this way recently? Okay, listen, I'd love to keep this conversation going with you, but I have work waiting for me, and truth be told, it's a common and miserable crime, the likes of which are too often seen in that neighborhood. Now, if you'll excuse me, good day, gentlemen. Leaving Lestrade's office, we tried to find a policeman who could tell us if Inspector Aberline is in the area. You're not in luck, a cooperative officer tells us. Frederick Aberline came by this morning to see Head Inspectors Swanson and Moore, but he just went back to the Commercial Street Police Station.
To the archives?
Yes, to the archives, I think. Agreed? 14WC to our old buddy Disraeli O'Brien! I finished the preliminary research requested by Scotland Yard, Disraeli informs us. Lestrade seems especially driven right now. Would you like to take a look before I pass this on? Okay, this is an entry from October 27th, 1887. Before Assistant Police Chief, the Honorable R.C. Huxley and Mr. C. Hoskins were heard William Grant Cork, alias Granger, for having savagely assaulted a woman named Maisie Hackle.
Okay.
He was suspected during the trial of belonging to the Nichols gang, condemned to 3 months of imprisonment at Millbank. Seems kind of light.
Yeah.
January 7th, 1888, Philip Rackstraw and his accomplices, all members of the gang of crooks known under the name of the Blind Beggar Gang, for their rackets of all sorts, invaded the establishment of a coffee maker on Fairclough Street, after having broken the windows and struck the customers with knives and brass knuckles, the seven culprits began to loot in earnest. They took all the wines and liquors they could. The police, called by the manager, rushed in, but the band had managed to escape, other than Philip Rackstraw, who was focused on forcing the register open, condemned to 7 weeks of prison at Newgate.
Wow. They've got connections.
Maybe. Holy shit, there's a page and a half of this stuff. February. What are the two last names of the similar cases? Maybe I can hear this.
Millwood and Molson, is that what they said?
Those are the next two.
I heard Smith, too.
That's right, we heard Smith earlier from Aberline, right?
Aberline, yeah.
Okay. Well, the next two are relevant, we hope. February 25th, 1888, Annie Millwood, widow, 38 years old, admitted to the infirmary of Baker's Row Asylum after receiving knife blows at leg and lower abdomen height. Hmm. Closed in May 1888. March 20th, 1888, Ada Wilson, 3 Maidman Street, Maidman, interesting, progressive even, seamstress, 30 years old, March 28th, assaulted at home by a man who stabbed her in the neck twice. The aggressor was in his 30s, had a black mustache, a worn bowler hat, and a light-colored pair of trousers. Closed in June 1888. The next one is about Jarvis Hilder, who met Mrs. Rainbow and her husband. Jarvis Hilder, who once had a relationship, offered them a drink. At nightfall, they were Mr. Rainbow fell asleep after becoming drunk. Jarvis told Mrs. Rainbow that to prove to her that he was no longer thinking about the past, he wanted to return to her all the letters that Mrs. Rainbow had once written to him. As he lived nearby, Mrs. Rainbow followed him. Once at the house, he called her a prostitute, tried to force himself on her, started punching. Anyway, he got arrested and he went to jail for 8 months. Let's see if we need to read any of the rest of these. Alphonse Holbrook, Cole Seller, attempted murder of Florence Wagstaff, a seamstress who had just married, when she was returning to her household. He, recently spurned by the young woman, rushed and dealt her a vicious knife wound. She lost consciousness, but she was wearing such a heavy corset that she was barely hit. He was condemned to 10 weeks of hard labor.
Jeez.
Charles Stiff and...
Maybe I know why they have so many crime problems.
Granted, maybe they would die in the course of that or something like that.
I didn't say she was wearing 2 bone corsets.
A whale bone corset, I think.
Would it be hard to stab through that?
I don't know if it covered the neck.
Well, for the
abdomen, yeah. Well, but maybe just waist up.
Maybe.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah. Charles Stiff and Vincent Nunn were surprised as they were administering a beating to 2 prostitutes on Sandy's Row in Whitechapel. Then fled, all the while insulting the constables. Taunted officers fell into an ambush, were struck down and brought to heel by a gang of 5 pimps, condemned to a month of hard labor. Charles Squibb, alias Squibby, accused of having stolen a watch and a fob and having threatened while pulling out a knife to stab the eyes out of the policeman who had just arrested him.
I'm Squibby.
Condemned to... Squibby all over. It's a pleasure to meet you. Condemned to 4 weeks of prison in Newgate.
4 weeks?
July 5th, 18... Maybe Newgate just churned... Just murdered...
Just stab your eyes out. Okay, 4 weeks.
Yeah. July 5th, 1888. Well, granted, they had much shorter life expectancy back then, so maybe it was like a proportional thing. At the Thames Tribunal was heard Kitty Winter, a shopkeeper from the Middlesex Street Market, for theft of clothing. She had lured to an alley of Little Somerset Street a child of 8 that she had stripped of clothing. Surprised by a police officer making his rounds, Kitty and her accomplice, who was keeping watch, attempted to flee. The officer caught up with the thief, and the accomplice managed to flee 2 weeks of solitary confinement. This is such a volume of woe. Robert Scarborough Carter, who coming home at 1 in the morning with his cart, was called out by a public woman on Commercial Street. Furious, he came down from his street and rushed the girl that he pelted with kicks. After having thrown her to the pavement, due to the shouts of the unfortunate officers rushed in, and 3 of them were barely enough to master the carter, he turned his fury on them. Condemned to 15 days of jail. Okay. So we have 1 more visit. Is that correct?
Yes.
Is the Nichols gang, is that just...
I think it's collateral. I don't think it's connected to what we're doing here.
No.
Yeah.
But is it not spelled the same as her last name? Is that...
Which one?
Isn't her last name Nichols? Nichols?
Yeah.
Oh my god! How did I not put that together?
Is that incidental?
Is it spelled the same?
Yes. No, it's absolutely the exact same.
Oh. Oh, well. Okay, one bleed left.
Oh, but wait. That's probably her husband's name, right?
William. Ex-husband.
Yeah,
right.
That would still be.
Yeah. But I still don't think that's connected. This is still so
weird.
Bizarre.
It's just a strange thing.
And we happen to know that three more women are going to get murdered.
And in most of these cases, if the perpetrators who were parts of gangs were doing something, they didn't flee before the police. They usually just stood and fought them all.
Yeah.
If possible.
Just really quick.
It seems too stealthy for a gang thing, too.
Looking back at what is this? I'm gonna pretend I didn't see that. Stern man in the prime of his years wearing a short beard. Just comparing the.
Yeah, it's a older athlete with a mustache.
Yes.
Yes.
Although that was so long ago, facial hair could have been changed.
Well, it's true. It was several months ago. Yeah, I mean, we could follow up with her. We can follow up with either of those two.
I
was just gonna say that we're kind of on the boat of Llewellyn doing it, right?
No. So we have one more stop.
Is there any other way for us to find out more information about him? Or?
Maybe something in the archive.
Hold on. Wasn't it the fact that... Yes. His wall is filled with information about his past.
Yes.
Diploma? Diploma of Squiggy Medical Studies from the London Hospital. Division Doctor's title from Her Majesty's Armories. A manuscript page making him a member of the British Gynecological Society.
Hmm. Huh.
Is that in the directory? Yeah, I bet London Hospital certainly is.
Someone take this.
Okay. I'll look.
Okay.
London Hospital is definitely in the directory. There. What was the British
Gynecological?
Gynecological. Yeah, let's have a look there. British Museum, British Museum Library, no. I think London Hospital would be the...
Can I take a quick look?
Yeah, go ahead. And this is just Gynecological Society. I didn't look under G yet.
I just wonder if, there's some esoteric category that we're omitting.
Have we been to his house?
Yeah, that's where we found that information out. Theaters, jewelers, libraries, tea rooms. The hospital might be our best bet.
London Hospital. Yeah,
have we any better idea?
I don't think I have a better idea. That's for sure. Yeah, that's the only part that's got me worried is it's the final round. But
yeah.
We might not really have a stronger one.
Yeah. And also, I'm not even sure what we're supposed to get this round. So.
Yeah,
it's not like it's good. Oh, it was Jack the Ripper.
Exactly, yeah.
That's true.
Well, I mean, it's right in the cover. Of course,
Well, in point of fact, they did not say that this is a Jack the Ripper story.
Mm-hmm.
But it is.
Yeah.
92E is our destination, sir.
All right. Whew.
You arrive at the hospital to find Jack the Ripper.
92E is not here.
No. Oh, excuse me. I'm looking at it.
This thing.
92E is the London Hospital.
Yeah. Okay. I had, one of those weird theoretical connections, but I wasn't sure if it was too dark.
Lay it on me.
After what we've read tonight.
Yeah, well, it was because of what we've read tonight.
We're all going to die.
So, I was thinking about, the Gynecological Society and its close proximity to all of these nefarious gangs, if when they were talking about these, sinister back alley abortions, if he might be responsible for them.
Oh yeah, maybe he's that guy.
And if that could be his motivation, is if there is something he wants to cover up, or, you know.
Did the woman that we accidentally interviewed not give us
82,
the location?
It was 82 something. I mean,
he does.
82E.
Oh, where's the newspaper? Oh, is it under there? I think it's under there.
cared about newspaper.
There's like, just so much, like, dark.
I asked her for the address of the midwife she'd seen. She gave it to me and even told me that thanks to her boyfriend, she could get a deal. Her boyfriend, presumably, was Freddy Broken Fingers, but it never actually gives the address of that place. Oh, Martine LeJunc.
Right, yes.
It said she went back to France, but we could still try the location.
We certainly could.
Seems like a happier one than...
Let's go to the junk and find out anything.
What should we do on our date? Now we're at the garbage dump.
Yes.
42E.
I love garbage.
Same.
42E.
42E. It's totally there.
Anime is
real. You're not garbage.
Jog boy.
Hello.
Oh, I'm glad we're here to be happy.
Man, Undertale is such a happier game than this.
42E does not appear to
be... Oh my god!
No! I refuse.
Oh, goodness. I mean, we don't have to. We could just stop.
No. If I just have to point and choose a place on the map, we're going to one more spot.
Okay, we could go to the Working Lads Institute.
No,
we went there, didn't we?
We may have retconned it, but we went there.
We could try the other pub that was randomly nearby just to get more random information that probably won't help.
No, I feel like we hit the winning pub.
Maybe.
We could look up her ex-husband or the person that she had a crush on. Just for random.
Blacksmith. That was years ago.
We could talk to Mycroft.
I thought the blacksmith was recent. Her ex-husband had last been seen 2 years ago.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
When their burned brother or child.
I think it's the doctor. The blacksmith doesn't give us much.
The only Nichols in the book, interestingly, is Evelyn Nichols. Wonder who that is. Is that her sister, maybe?
Well, she had a lot of children. Maybe one of them still lives in the city.
Ah, maybe.
Want to try Evelyn Nichols?
No.
Okay. Not particularly. Any other tavern still.
We could try one of these.
Yeah.
Quentin Hogg.
What's he do?
Source of information for criminal cases.
Possibly. We already have a lot of criminal case info.
That's true.
And I didn't really feel like any of those cases seemed connected.
No, following Lestrade's lead may have been a mistake.
Wasn't there something about Telegraph?
Could talk to the London Times and see if we can figure out why they got such a different report.
That's true, we could do that.
Henry Ellis.
Although I'm thinking that was probably, well, not innocent necessarily, but not super connected.
No, it's second or third hand information.
We could talk to the other guy from the morgue.
Oh, that's true. We could do that.
Well, what's the other guy
his name?
I have to look up the original morgue entry for that.
Which is 24.
Well, I can go like that one. It's connected to the doctor, at least.
Yep.
It's almost certain to be.
Our nemesis, Dr. Morgman.
Yeah. James Hatfield is at the address of
23 Polo Street.
There's also, like, other locations where she had been known to stay at and things like that.
Yeah, he doesn't have an address in here, so we might need to double-check the morgue entry, which is 24E. That's all right.
I was looking at those, pictures from the beginning. 24E.
So, right here, it starts talking about James Hatfield, but
yes.
Is there any indication of where he lives?
He's a colleague from the morgue who must have arrived around 6. Went back to the cold bodies room, undressed stiff, blah, blah, blah. Water and phenolic acid. Does that seem suspicious? I don't know what that kind of acid does.
What is it? What kind of acid?
Phenolic?
Phenolic.
They referred to it as perfume at one point. Is it possible it just makes it smell better? I mean, not better, like in a normal perfume sense, like...
Yeah, I'm thinking of like a something that preserves it.
Yeah,
like
embalming stuff.
Well, I mean, this is the kind of place that throws them in a big
trash
ditch.
Yeah. Calling for, I don't know, they don't mention too much more about him.
They mentioned, didn't they tell us other places where she was known to hang out?
Well, there was the bar that she was seen at before the church, but
the frying pan.
Maybe she went back there after she made her cache.
She didn't go to the crown.
That's true.
Let's go to the frying pan.
You know that'll be in the book.
17.
It's not a kind of black polo take my place.
17. All right. The frying... I get the sorted... I get all the sorted ones.
Oh, no.
The frying pan is a sorted pub with a washed-out sign on the corner of Finch Street and Brick Lane. On the doorstep, prostitutes try to find clients among the passerby.
Hell yeah.
A badly shaven doorman, pipe in mouth and billy club up his sleeve, gauges us as we enter. We find a space not too far from a dirt-encrusted man, bald on the top of his head.
Just a man just like with dirt like over every inch of skin.
Occupied by looking above him at the gleam of the gas lamp lighting up the smoke-filled room. All while stuffing a clay pipe with his thumb, using coarsely chopped tobacco. His clothes seem too large, and his frayed cuffs are black as his fingernails.
Sounds lovely.
Upon our arrival, he begins to complain.
Same.
Friends! Cohorts! Greetings! It's because of that damn gas that I'm losing my mane.
I take one.
And they have the balls to call this a gin palace. The barkeep, without paying the least attention to our neighbor, pours us a glass of his best rye whiskey, and Wiggins takes the chance to interrogate him. He learns that Polly was here on the night of the crime, and that she left the pub at around 1 a.m, alone and imbibed, having contributed greatly to making the place more lively. As we are about to walk out of the pub, a large, mature woman with a florid complexion grabs Wiggins by the arm. With her scratchy voice burned by alcohol, she whispers, "You're investigating Polly's murder, young man?" Yes, question mark. answers Wiggins. "Call me Pearly Pole. I think she was killed by a man who has a grudge against the prostitutes of Whitechapel. I was a friend of Martha Tabram, you know, the one who was murdered in 67 George Yard Building. And earlier, other girls have been assaulted in our neighborhood. It's the Nichols gang turf here, but we haven't seen them much since August. They were there then to wring money from us, but as soon as there's danger, we don't feel too protected anymore. The other girls, could we meet them? I knew one. She was called Belinda Wishart. I haven't seen her in the pub for a while, but I think she still lives in the neighborhood." "Where exactly?" That I wouldn't be able to tell you. "Well, thanks for your help, Pearly." As we leave the tavern, outside, a thick soot-laden fog has swept over the streets. Well, Fluff, there's a new lead is our last thing.
Mm. Let's solve the case.
We can follow it and just take 5 points off for every extra lead we
go. It works that way during the campaign. Yeah. It said to go to questions as soon as you get the team.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Maybe there's not that much information, so they didn't want us to go too long.
Yeah, that's true, because we, unlike every other case, we're not necessarily going to solve this one the same way.
Are we ready?
Yes.
All right.
I will scribe our answers.
Here is the first series of questions.
Okay.
Number one, why did no one in Buck's Row hear the crime?
She was strangled.
Strangled first.
Strangled first, or do we still think she was moved, maybe?
I don't think she was moved.
Okay. I think it was because she was strangled.
Strangled while drunk. Sure,
passed out.
I guess strangled plus drunkenness. Was it that? Okay.
Number two, what was the position of the killer in relation to his victim when the mutilations took place?
Position?
Yeah.
The position.
Like physically?
I assume
not socially.
Although she was on her back at one point, propped up at another point. The blood might be relevant too, because they talked a fair bit in some of the clues about the way the blood would have drained based on how she was positioned.
So I think the answer is that she was lying down and he was on top of her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know what else I would be asking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Number three, was Marianne Nichols' killer left or right-handed, according to previous answer?
left-handed. Oh. Maybe he's asking...
Huh?
Oh, well, maybe... Okay, left, right? Maybe this is based on how he strangled her, whether he was standing... Like, if she was lying down, if he was standing, like, where her head is, or maybe he was standing, like, below her.
Or I'm almost thinking it's more of, if she is laying down... I'm,
like, where is he standing?
You know, is he standing over top of her like this, or over top of her like this?
I don't know why that matters, but...
I also don't know why that matters.
Well, all I know is that Meek said that she was punched in the left side, saying that the killer was left-handed.
If he left-handed, if he went like this, but he'd right-handed if she was on the ground and he went the other way.
Yeah.
And that might be determined by how I don't know. I have no idea how we would know that.
I mean, yeah, we're like reverse engineering the first question.
That's not a question that I expected.
Yeah, that almost makes me want to go back and look at the, like, the detailed, like, you know... Like,
yeah, he gave a lot of information about how this...
How the slashes occurred.
They all came from left side of the neck.
We want to just say if we see the answer and feel like we had enough information, if we've been willing to knock on it...
Yeah, absolutely.
Assuming that it doesn't obviously involve some detail we just didn't have.
Yeah, I mean, that's entirely possible.
Okay.
You're gonna love the next one.
Okay.
Number four. Which assaulted and or killed women were in all likelihood not victims of Marianne Nichols' killer, according to previous answer?
Oh, because they weren't killed by a left-handed person. Yeah. You have to go through those reports from that guy. Want to do the same thing? Just going to say, if we feel like we knew that answer.
I think we can list both of those ones from the past that we got.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Okay, what were they?
Millwood and Wilson?
Yeah.
Millwood, Wilson.
Okay. Number five. Among the other women, which victim shows the most similar profile?
I feel like we're getting close to it at the very end.
I was going to say, maybe this other prostitute that was assaulted.
Yeah.
What was her name?
I don't know.
Belinda. Belinda
bought some butter.
She was assaulted? She wasn't just a witness or something? I couldn't remember.
Yes, she was an actual victim.
Okay, Belinda.
At the other... at the Angela and Crown, they're talking about other women who had abortions and things. Were any of those women assaulted?
By gang members.
By gang members, yes. Yeah. But that will get into the second series of questions. Okay. Number six, who had reason to harm Freddie Broken Fingers?
Freddie was the lady's boyfriend or something?
Something?
Or she was the boyfriend of the lady who had an abortion who could get a deal?
Yeah, who was that?
Who's trying to get info out of them?
Yeah, someone was definitely trying to get info on how to find Freddy. But we need to look at 80, I think 80, Angel and Crown again, 8280.
What's the question? Is who would want?
Yeah,
who would want to Freddy?
Clearly,
I went to see her, and coming out, three young men stopped me, wanting to know where Freddy Broken Fingers and Emma were. I told them I had no clue, so their leader threw me to the ground. So if it was a group, I assume it was the Nichols gang.
Nichols gang, okay.
There were seven. Why?
Seven. Why? That one I don't think we dug enough on the gangs.
Yeah.
To stop abortion?
What did it say about Broken Fingers or whatever?
Who wanted to rough him up and why? Maybe because they didn't like these guys, maybe Dr. Llewellyn, making money and cutting them out of the process.
Okay. Dr. Llewellyn.
They wanted a cut of the action.
I don't know. Action. Okay.
Ooh, this is a tough
one. It is.
It is. What's next?
Are you guys, that's the solution. Are you guys ready to find out what the heck's going on?
Yes.
Sure.
I need a foundation to go forward.
Oh my god. To our great surprise, Holmes and Watson are present in Aberline's office.
Aberline and Watson seem to have performed the usual social niceties in front of a silent Holmes and are thrilled by our arrival. We therefore relay all of the information collected during the day, and Holmes for once doesn't interrupt us. Whitechapel murder is singular at more than one level, begins Holmes at the end of our tale. There's a murder of nameless level of barbarism. Sure, the neighborhood isn't the safest, but attacking a prostitute and inflicting such mutilations on her really doesn't make any sense for a gang of the area. This attracts too much attention. Thus, knowing if Polly's murder is an isolated case or the continuation of a series is critical information for the investigation. In case of a series, the older the murders are, and the more they risk they involve those close to the murderer. Following the path back to the source of evil is often the best way to discover it. Investigating those close to Marianne Nichols is therefore useless? Asks Aberline, disappointed. Not useless, but investigating the circumstances of her death may prove more useful. The autopsy report is most interesting. Firstly, knowing whether the victim was strangled or had her throat slit. Lewin believes that her throat was slit, intervenes Wiggins. There would have been many more projections of blood at the crime scene. After the heart stopped, the blood flowed slowly from her throat and into her hair and clothes. It's what we call gravity, Wiggins. In addition, due to the discreet nature of her murder, strangulation is more credible. Or maybe the body was moved, tries Wiggins. Officer Neal, once at the scene, explored that hypothesis, and there was no trace of wheels, no drag marks in that blood, that of the blood, when the body was found. I know you dream about being an actor, Wiggins, but your imagination sometimes makes you lose sight of the reality of the facts. I'll remind you, evidence is the basis of all investigation, not romantic speculations.
I do like that.
An embarrassed silence ensues.
I thought it was a great theory, Wiggins.
Uh-oh. Watson breaks it. The murderer thus performed his mutilations post-mortem. Abilene can't repress a disgusted grimace. Yes, answers Holmes. The body was lying on its back alongside a wooden door, the head at the left side of the door. Where was the murderer when he performed his mutilations? That's what Llewellyn didn't extrapolate in his report. Is that important? Asks Abilene. Yes, to know if the murderer is right or left-handed. The man almost decapitated his victim, and the finger marks on the victim's face gives us the support position of the murderer's hand when he made the incision, from left to right, with his other hand. The violence of that act required him to be completely at ease to perform it. The murderer wasn't directly in front of the body, as it was right up against the door. I am not getting, like, the visual of, like, up against the door at all. So he must have been at its side. In that case, the thumb of your left hand is on the right cheek while your right hand is holding the knife.
Oh,
Wiggins okay. Motions, trying to visualize the crime scene on Luke. On Luke? Oh, like on the man named Luke who is part of our party of people.
Yeah, he's the one yeah. Who
can pick
locks.
Got it. Be careful not to slice your own wrist, Wiggins, smiles Holmes before continuing. We are dealing with a right-handed man no matter what Llewellyn says. Now, back to our victims. Our group shouts the name of the earlier cases. Ada Wilson! According to the drawing, assaulted by a right-handed man, and even if the motive is not clear at the time, he could be the same man as Polly's killer. Annie Millwood? Yes, all evidence points to a right-handed man. Belinda Wishart? No, that was a left-handed man. Martha Tabram? The modus operandi is quite similar. Quiet place, not a sound made. Many blows delivered with a certain level of barbarism. The medical examiner will confirm it was done by a right-handed person, I'm sure. Here, again, we can't exclude it. It's even the most similar case. Emma Smith? That's an easy one to solve. Gang rather than an isolated single man, a victim left alive, an abuse which is more like a message or vengeance compared to blind brutality. Right or left-handed, no matter. Only Lestrade would see a link there. Aberline makes an embarrassed cough. As I am unfortunately afraid that Polly's murder won't be enough to unmask the culprit, we need to be vigilant in the upcoming weeks. Aberline comes out of his reserve. I wasn't lied to about your investigative talents or to those of your team. You can count on my full cooperation, as well as those of Coroner Baxter, court mandated on this case. I'll guarantee it. From now on, you got a pen there, Fieldy? Because legacy style, I need you to update some information.
Sure.
From now on, Head Inspector Aberline, found at 100 EC, down at the very bottom, and Corner Wynn.
Hmm. Oh, I'm sorry, what?
100 EC.
For
Aberlane.
100 EC?
Yep, and Baxter at 10 E at the Working Lads Institute are considered to be informants. Indeed. Holmes did not take part in this investigation for completion's sake. The conclusion was written with the help of the following leads. So, these are the leads used to solve the case. Commercial Street Police Station, 100 EC. Mm-hmm. Sir Jasper Meeks, 38 EC. Bucks Row, 2 E.
Is that somewhere in the line? Yes. No, the crime scene.
Yeah, the crime scene. Officer Neal at 123 E.
Mm-hmm.
The Criminal Archives at 14 WC, which we went to right after Scotland Yard, I think.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Somerset House, 17 WC. I don't think that we went there.
No, that's the births, deaths, marriages, wills place.
Yes, yes. The Frying Pan.
Mm. Go there.
Belinda Wishart, which we did not visit.
Oh.
George Yard, which we did not visit.
Oh.
Ada Wilson, who we did not visit. Baker's Row Asylum. In George Street. I wonder if it has... Yes! So, this envelope that we have here has the information of the score. Would you care to take a look?
Chapter 1, Marianne Nichols. First series. Is this...
These are the answers, I think.
Marianne Nichols, killer, strangled his victim before slitting her throat, or because of the sound of a nearby train. Ah, for one. Both answers are acceptable.
Okay.
15 points.
Yes!
15.
We did it.
15 points.
All right.
Well done, everyone. Well done.
Okay.
Number two, Marianne Nichols was lying on her back with her left side against a door. The assassin had to be beside her.
So I guess she was lying on the ground, but like up against a wall.
Yeah, I thought like prop dog.
Yeah.
That's what I thought too. Okay, that's 20 points.
Like, we had the information.
Yeah, we just
interpreted it incorrectly.
I did not aggressively enough suggest that we go back and see what they were saying about him having the handprints on her face.
But I think we still would have lost because of all this other stuff about the other victims.
Number three, he was right-handed.
Nope.
15 points. Number four, the other similar women, Belinda Wishart and Emma Smith. Did we have any of those?
Not for number four.
Okay. Any other woman named will cost you 15 points.
Did we not say Belinda Wishart?
Jesus. Did we not say Belinda Wishart?
We said that for a different one.
Yeah, not for that one.
So minus 30 on number four. Oh,
no. And then five is Martha Tabram.
Oh.
I don't even remember who that is.
I don't think we met her.
I don't think we
met. What was the question? Six?
Who wanted
dead? Yeah, six. William Grant Granger, called the Rabbit.
Oh, right! We literally read the report on it.
Oh.
And his accomplices from the Nichols Gang.
Oh. Well, we said Nichols Gang.
How much points is that?
20 points total.
A half.
Alright.
Half.
Seven. Yeah, what was the question?
Why? Why did they mean him harm?
Okay. Emma Smith and her protector, Freddy, were blackmailing Martine Lejeune.
Not a thing. So, from the questions, we got -5 points.
To tally your score, add the points obtained by answering the questions. 80 points is considered to be a success. If you followed more than 15 leads, the investigation is a failure.
So you auto-fail if you go over 15.
Apparently.
So our score is -5.
All right.
We did such a bad job.
We had
the information.
Yeah, we're rusty.
I think we just got lazy at the end. We're
I
like,
am so lazy. I do not care.
We're like, oh, well, we could figure that out, or we could just whatever.
I think it was really confusing.
I think we shouldn't make assumptions on
prostitutes.
Places, because like we were like, the tavern or whatever, right? We're like, frying pan, no, that's where she was before.
Yeah.
So, but then it turns out there was somebody that was like...
Of course there was. Yeah. She hung out there all the time. Of course someone there knew her.
So I guess we should avoid going to the police station early on.
Do you know what that is? That's exactly what Sherlock says to avoid every single time. Don't make assumptions. Go on the facts. Yeah. Evidence is the basis for investigation. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But no, it said to include all previous leads.
Oh, I thought it...
No, 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 yeah.
Yeah, it didn't...
It said, starting from there...
You don't actually find out that one.
Yeah.
That's the limit until you go there.
No, man. It was good that we hit it first.
Yeah, it was actually good we hit it first. We would have gone over 15 and just auto-failed.
Oh, yeah. My God.
Instead of passing with a negative 5.
All right. Good game, regardless.
Good game.
I feel... Yeah.
That was our warm-up. Sit back in...
This prostitute was our warm-up. But the next one...
I had to pee, or I... Couldn't figure that out.
Well, that will serve you right.
Oh. With that, we only would have dug back up to 25.
Okay, so 80. We would have been able to figure that out. We would have known he was right-handed. We could have looked at the cases and determined who was killed by something similar.
I think you're overestimating my laziness.
We didn't even have all the cases.
Mm-hmm. We would have had some of them.
Yeah.
And some.
I mean, from, like, what we know about the crimes and what we know about from the murder and everything.
Good game.
GG.
We failed to save her in time. At all. thank you guys for playing. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for the outstandingly generous donation. That is absolutely terrific. I am over the moon, regardless of the fact that the moon is missing. We'll see you on Tuesday for more Dungeon and Dragon type adventures, and we'll see you next week for more Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective Jack the Ripper and West End adventures. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
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 Say
bye.